everybody.
You go, Don.
No, hi. How you doing?
Hi. So I'm Cinnamon Cooney, the Art Sherpa, and the hi, how you doing is John, my husband. He's back there in the control booth. This is Heart Party, and if it's your very first time here, what we do is show you step by step by step how to do a painting. Today's painting is this fabulously adorable 1945 F-150 truck broken down in a field for you to do. So we're going to be covering rust today. We're going to be covering how to sketch this in. But this time, in the description with the materials and all the other stuff, we have the link to the traceable that's there ahead of time. Oh my gosh. So you could do it on an 8x10 like this, just with your home computer, transfer the image to here, and there you go. How awesome is that? We're doing acrylic paint, in case you didn't know. I wear a Pikachu hat. That's a thing that happens as well. We absolutely cover serious art, we just don't cover it seriously. Because that's kind of our thing. Who's in the house today, John?
Oh my gosh, it's so full out there. And I'm going to double check here. I want to make sure there are sounds, not too much.
We wanted to do a pre-show.
Yeah, we were trying to do a pre-show to make sure that we weren't...
If the sound is at all pitchy or tinny or loud, give us 2 seconds. Don't click out.
It says that it's fuzzy. It says that we have fuzzy sound.
We have fuzzy sound. What does the community say?
Yeah, the sound is weird.
Sound to you.
Everybody says that there's some fuzzy sound, that maybe it's me. I'll try to back mine down and see if we can just... Okay, it's better. They say it's better.
Don't click away. Stay with us.
We got it.
We always get this together. Also, don't let the fact that this lesson seems a little bit long compared to everything else on YouTube stop you from painting. If you're here with the live community, they're going to be telling you, no, this is just like the most fun ever. But if you're coming up after the live broadcast to do this lesson, hang in, because this really is the best way on the internet to get the painting, especially if you're new to art. There just isn't really a 20-minute tutorial that teaches new beginners how to complete the painting. It's good for me, though. I like to see them.
Cool.
Yeah.
So it sounds like we may have a little weird echo, but we're going to work it through this time, and then we'll try to reset our audio next time. But it sounds like it's survivable.
Is it survivable, or is there a real echo, or do we want to reset? What do we want to do?
Pete says it's okay. He says it's survivable.
Later, if you're watching and you're not enjoying the sound, instead of like going after me about it, go find Pete.
Yep.
Who said it was fine. He's just opted you in for the sound. It's like Pete's out. Materials today, I have a 16x20 canvas. We're going to sketch in our image. I pre-sketched it in, but I'm going to show you how I broke it down. I use watercolor pencils. I'm really liking these, but you can use kids' chalk. You can use Conti crayons. You can use any of the chalks, but the watercolor pencils are nice, and they now have a cheap, inexpensive set of Artist Lofts and Michaels, which is like $6 and is almost totally worth doing. I'm painting professional grade acrylic paints, right? What does that mean? Well, in the art store, there's student paints, that's tier one. There's mid-level professional, that's tier two. And then there's pro paints, there's tier three. And the difference to that is the binders being stable and the pigment load being heavy. Binders being stable, what does that mean? Well, if you put too much water in a beginner paint and then you go to varnish, the whole thing's gonna streak, because the paint won't be stabilized. And so that can give you some trouble, and it can give you some trouble like paint lifting up off of other paint. And you might have to paint a couple of coats. Doesn't mean don't do it. Doesn't mean you can't get a good painting. I've done a great painting with student paints. It's just know that there's limitations to those paints. And I like to be unlimited, so I paint pro, which is stuff like Liquitex Heavy Body.
Mm-hmm.
The Golden paint, which is, you know, and then of course I'm also a huge fan of the Matisse structure.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the brands of paint that I'm painting. That's what I'm doing today. I don't know what I'm doing today. Truck.
We're doing an awesome truck. Could you do me a favor?
Yeah.
Could you grab the right Pikachu ball and throw it over your right shoulder? It keeps rubbing on that mic, making it sound all scratchy. Perfect. We did it.
I caught them all.
Got them all.
I got them all. This is my Loot Crate hat.
Is that where you got that one from,
yeah,
Loot Crate?
Yeah, it is. By the way, those of you who've asked me to speed up and teach this lesson in a more speedy fashion, probably not today. Sorry, it's not that I take the notes, I take what you guys have to say and do my best, but sometimes the day just gets Elmer.
What you got there in your sippy sippy?
I got caramel Starbucks coffee with soy creamer.
Ooh, that looks good.
In my Elmer cup.
Ooh.
My Elmer cup, which is my favorite happy mug.
Happy.
Colors. We could cover those.
Yep. And
would you like to know what the colors are?
We need to know the colors and we need to do our wishes.
We're going to do wishes and colors. First colors, then wishes.
All right, what colors? Scoot that palette up a little bit so we can see it better.
Okay. All right. So.
What do we have?
We have a iron oxide. Yeah, no, we don't.
No. Nope.
We have...
What is it?
We have yellow ochre.
Yellow ochre.
We don't have any iron oxide. That's not it. Some of the paint is made with iron oxide. But we have yellow ochre.
Yep.
Clearly, we needed more coffee. We have burnt sienna.
Uh-huh.
We have phthalo blue. We have dog's mane purple. We have cad yellow medium. And to save money, you can buy hue. Note on that, because you guys keep getting confused about the cad yellow medium hue thing. What it is that the high-end paints, like Golden and Liquitex, will have true cadmium, a whole lot of money, and hue, much, much less money. All student or entry-level paints, it's always hue. Always.
Always.
Always. So you don't even have to worry about it. And I love to do this to John, so he's got to go camera, 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 camera. If you have health concerns, you're painting with somebody young, probably should do hue. Okay, I'm gonna go back to palette cam. So that's cad red medium, cad yellow medium. These come in like deep and light and medium, and so that's what it is. Dog's mane purple, burnt sienna, titanium white, and phthalo blue. Another area that we keep having trouble, and I'm gonna talk to you guys about this, and hopefully you guys can see this. Am I there? Do you see what it says green shade? All right, Liquitex, Winsor & Newton, I think one other brand, puts this thing green shade, red shade. Basically, green shade mixes really, really pretty colors. Red shade is a close cousin to ultramarine, and I've done some stuff on Periscope about color mixing, if you watch that, but basically it won't give you the same green. So what you want is, if you're buying Liquitex, it needs to say green shade. If you're buying a student paint, it says polyethicane blue, it actually is already green shade. They don't even bother with giving you red shade. So hopefully that helps a little bit in the art store. Painting acrylic brushes. Gonna paint filbert. Gonna paint a bright, and I'm gonna paint some detail, some rounds, and I'm gonna find a detail round, like a detail round. And I'm just gonna cover this real quick. This is a brush for acrylic, Teclon fibers, medium flick back. I do them in, it's in the description where I like to hide things. Usually in a 1-inch, 1/2-inch, and 1/4-inch range in each of the shapes. Filberts are round, brights are sharp squares, and details are also like these little detail rounds. And I'm getting my sound adjusted. Is it on my tinny?
No, quick swap the battery.
Oh. So I just wanted to cover that because I've just been getting a lot of questions about that. I was going to cover all that stuff in the pre-show, so it wasn't here for your new lesson, people. But if you're here for the new lesson, I'm sorry about the long intro. Don't click out. We're going to totally paint, and then it's going to go fast.
Tell me you'll be back in just a second.
I'll be back in just a second.
Ah. Or not.
Don't click away.
Fixed.
This is really the best. This is just a great show. Hopefully everyone in the comments is saying, it is. Hang in with her. She knows what she's doing.
This is the advantage of live.
This is the advantage of live, is that I get to have my, instead of us finding out at the end of filming a video that I didn't have sound, we'd have it. So this should be everything you need to know if you're a first day person. Painting. The reason I'm doing this on this painting is I know it's going to attract a lot of new painters who want to paint a 1945 F-150 truck.
Yep.
So I just want to make sure the new people who just got here for the first time today had all the stuff that they kind of needed to know to get in.
So we can't forget our wishes.
Wishes. Yes.
We must do our wishes.
We must do our wishes. And if we have any in the comments, let me know.
Yep.
But I know I've got a wish.
Well, we've had some definite wishes in the comments. I know we have some wish for some better, for better employment, for some better health.
And who's wishing for employment?
Oh my gosh, I have to scroll back. It was there was a husband that was looking for some better employment, I think. It was early on, so I'd have to scroll way back. I'd even be able to get back that far right now. And I know I saw some folks asking for wishes on health.
I know I have a bunch of that. I have one up here I've got to do. I've got someone who's wishing for a liver.
Okay, yeah, that's important.
Right. And we have a bunch of people wishing. We have a bunch of members who sent me in wishes, like a shocking number of them, about a cessation from pain. So I'm going to wish that there comes a better pain, like a less pain. We're going to wish for less pain for them. What am I doing, John?
What are you doing? What do you mean, what are you doing?
Well, did you want to explain what I'm doing? Why I'm putting wishes in there?
Well, we put the wishes in there because we want to, we try to fill all of our paintings with love and to put that into the universe so that, you know, everybody can have some of it, you know?
Yeah, if you just went into art lesson, you didn't show up to the right place.
Yeah, no.
You're going to get the art lesson, but then there's going to be some stuff like you should feel optimistic. You should feel like you can wish for things. I like to write wishes into canvases as a thing I've done a long time in my studio. I write wishes for people that I love and care about, and I've got quite a few that I have to put in. Do you see any more wishes I need to put in?
Oh, gosh.
I have a wish for Mark. And you know what I'm wishing for, Mark.
Oh, yeah. We have Kim's carpenter. He has kidney cancer. We should wish well for him and everyone else who's fighting cancer.
This is my wish. I wish, and you're going to hear this a bunch from me this month, because this is the month we're going to be talking about this a lot. I think that there is going to be in our lifetime an end to particular illness, and I think cancer is one of them. I really believe this, and so I'm going to wish for that. I'm going to wish for an end to cancer.
Yeah.
And then an end to his cancer.
Yep. And I think it's Carrie's husband, mm-hmm. who's underemployed.
All right. Oh, okay. I put that down here.
Cool. And
wish for Carrie.
And Casper is getting knee surgery next month.
Oh, quick recovery, fast healing.
Yeah, and you know, my dad's had at least one knee surgeries, and you know, it was tough. But you know, and he's a tough guy.
And you know what? You guys don't know this, but our friend Bobby Wall just had a stroke, so we're gonna wish her a fast recovery. And then I have another wish for a child for well-being and feeling good in school.
And Duchess would like wishes for my father, for my father's recovery. So we wish Duchess's father a quick recovery.
Duchess's father's recovery.
Yeah.
Well, I hope he has a wonderful recovery. So this is a wonderful wish truck.
And then
I wish for my community, my YouTube community. I wish all of you a beautiful, abundant, healthy, happy week.
Yes.
You can get specific with these wishes. Right.
Wishes are good. Put them
wishes
on your canvas.
Wishes are good. Put them on your canvas.
Like, you just fill it
I
out.
Mean, I don't want to be like all Walt Disney on you, but dude, it works.
Yeah, we're putting good intention out there.
What painting are we doing? Don't click out.
Ooh.
We're doing this painting. Don't click out.
Why are we doing a Ford?
F-150?
Yeah.
I have no idea.
Because there's no dead Chevys.
I'm going to start with a filbert Creative Mark Ebony Splendor. I'm going to show you about the measurement. About this big. Why do I show you guys these measurements? Because the brush companies don't have universal sizing. So I'm going to say just a little under an inch. And I'm going to start blocking this guy in.
Yep.
And so I'm going to get my brush wet. I'm going to break the heel a little bit. See, I press down here and I break that heel.
Yep,
that opens up my brush and gets it ready to take
push
paint.
Push it forward. Push the canvas. Push that palette up there a little bit. So we can see. There you go. Perfect.
I'm breaking. So this is like an interesting thing. It's called warming up a brush. I'm going to take a little of my phthalo blue over to my burnt sienna. And I'm going to get a nice gray blue. This is one of our my favorite color mixes. Notice how I'm mixing from the edge of my paint plops, and I'm utilizing my palette paper here to pull my paint out and get a nice mix. I'm going to add a scotch, a smidge, a small amount of white. And I'm going to paint all... Oh, you know what I didn't do?
What's that?
Sketch in the car.
You did... Oh.
Oh, everyone is going to click out of this painting. I almost feel like I should do it over.
It's... Think you're doing just fine.
Guys, I'm so sorry today. I'm normally... You. Please tell them I'm on point normally.
We got our wishes in.
You
know, Lindsay's just joined us too. She's in here to say hello.
Hey, Lindsay, I just lost my mind today. How are you doing?
I think
I loved your sheep. Loved them. Loved them. You got to go by and comment on them, but I loved them.
So how are we going to sketch in the truck today?
I think what we're going to do is we're going to use our ruler, and I'm just going to tell you how I blocked this out, and you guys are going to remember that you have a traceable.
All right.
Send me light and love, Lindsay. I'm having a moment.
So the traceables will be available after the show and the links.
No, they're available right now.
They're available right now in the links. That's
yeah,
right.
So I'm going to make a mark 4 inches up from the bottom of my canvas on either side. Because once I've anchored my bumper, everything else will build off my bumper. I do this a lot in sketching where I find one object where I want it to be. Now I'm going to draw a not perfect, but as level as I can make it line across. Right, in my watercolor pencil, because it'll wash away, and that's what's nice. I'm going to come about an inch, maybe like an inch and a quarter above this first line and make a parallel line. And then what I've essentially done is I created the bumper. Once I know where the bumper is, I can build all kinds of things on my truck after. So I've got 3 inches down from the bumper. Okay, and it's about a half inch, like over here, and an inch and a half over here, about an inch and a half over here, and 3 inches down. This is just for you guys that want to sketch this in. I'm going to make a line, looks like I'm about a 2-inch line at the bottom, and this is my wheelbase, and I'm going to come almost all the way over to the edge of my canvas and make a sister line to this. So I've got these two lines here. This is the bottom of my tires. Now listen, guys, you don't have to be too perfect. I know you got car people in your lives, and it's really scary to draw for car people, train people, car people. Very difficult.
And it is a Ford, so not everything is going to line up anyway.
This makes my point exactly. Car people. So I've got to get certain aspects of the wheels correct, but I don't have to get every aspect of the wheels correct. So be brave with me. And we're going to do this. Now, how I'm going to make is I'm going to make a curved line. It's like a parentheses. It's a curved line that comes up to my bumper. It's about a finger in. Mm-hmm. You could make that mark. We knew it was a half inch from earlier. I'm going to make a parallel curved line. We're working on some perspective here, guys, that makes up to this tire line.
Yeah.
See that? Super, super simple. Doesn't feel simple when you're doing it, though. Feels really aggravating. Now, about 2 inches, I'm going to make another little mark here. And I'm going to create a line that curves the opposite way and comes down and meets this bottom line. This is the illusion, right, guys? I'm going to do this parentheses over here.
Mm-hmm.
And my parentheses on this far end, it'll go off the canvas.
And why do you make it go off the canvas?
I make it go off the canvas because some of my car is going off the canvas. This is a very static painting. So if some of the object goes off the canvas, it tells a story about a world outside of our painting. Tells a story of a world outside of our painting. And you want to tell that story. You want the world to seem bigger than your canvas.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to come in and I'm going to make this little opposing parenthesis shape down. And you'll notice that starts to tell the story of a three-dimensional object. We obviously don't have a three-dimensional object here. We have to create a cipher, right? Ah. James George was talking about that recently on Periscope, and I loved it. It's the cipher of three-dimensional objects. So that's what we're doing, is we're talking to our brain about what this could be. Mm. So now I'm going to come up, and it is it is 4 1/4 inches above here. And on the other side, it's going to be bigger, so I'm going to get that line later. I'm going to start at a 4 1/4 inch line, and I make a little hump up. It's a little mountain, a little round shape.
Hmm.
Okay. My little microphone just came off.
That's okay. You're still going. It's just the clip.
Yeah. And this is quite an object to draw in, guys, so I don't want you to stress out. Now, about the middle mark of your canvas, almost on the same level as this first hump, make a little mark here. Oh, hey, it's our lawn guys today. Is the dog in?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, that's good. I don't want to get sued today. The dog really wants to eat the lawn guys. So I use that middle mark as another anchor. All right, now it's about a finger, a half inch, an inch over here. And 5 inches up, because this one is going off the canvas, so we're going to see more of a higher line. I make that little line.
Let me take care of this.
This is our dog. It's very easy to make this arced hump here. Our arced hump here. Right there. Do you guys see that? How is that? Let me show that to you. These are really simple shapes. They're just, it's how these objects go together that make a canvas come together. And listen, drawing is not what I want. I'm not like trying to make you guys draw it. I'm just saying if you want to start working on those skills for drawing, I'm going to have a sippy sippy. While my dog is barking. What a weird lesson today. And it's going to be on YouTube forever and ever and ever. My dog barking in my Pikachu hat. Live. So fun. So hopefully once you have these things anchored out, right, the rest of this object just builds like Legos. A lot of times when I'm doing a drawing, it is like Legos for me. And I'm just trying to figure out where is this one object and what next shape can I understand in that space. Now, once I have these little humps, I'm going to tell a little story. I'm going to make a slightly... not an up and down vertical line, it's a slightly diagonal line, and that will help inform this inner grill that comes down here.
Perfect.
Right? Isn't that nice? That's just an easy thing. My favorite one is this Ford logo, and I altered this just a little bit to make it more drawable. You're going to come up about 1/4 inch on either side and just make a line across. That's all you have to do.
Why don't you pull the close-up camera? I know that this is kind of an important thing for Ford people, because this is the line that helps people understand that it's a Ford.
Yeah. Now, in real time, this actually arcs down, but that becomes another complex curve, and I'm trying to limit the number of complex curves you guys are dealing with today. And sometimes, if you tell the story closely enough, but loosely enough, the brain fills it out. So I've got two lines coming down on either side of this. It's a little over an inch. It's about 1 1/4 inches. It's going to tell this. And that gives us this shape of this metal that we're going to do. Then on the arc going up about 1 inch, we can make a straight line vertically coming on the other side. It's a little further in than 1 inch. It's about 1 1/4 inches, 1 1/2 inches. We're going to make another straight line vertically. I'm going to hold this up for you guys again. See how we're going. I don't know if this helps. We need to have a picture-in-picture like sitting over here on the side, but we haven't worked that out yet. You can also go and get that picture off the Facebook page and print it out to look at it while you're painting this, just so you know. So I'm going to come up on each side here. I'm going to come up about an inch and a half, and I'm going to arc another curve, goes off the canvas. This is the top of this really tall, crazy hood. And because of the angle of this perspective, I'm going to come in a quarter of an inch, eighth of an inch, with a parallel line that goes an inch and a half up, and then I'm going to take the curve off. Isn't that interesting?
Interesting, yeah.
It's interesting. But it's the thing that I've got to do. I'll draw this girl right here. So right underneath here, intersecting my point, is a line that looks like it's about a 7.5-inch line. About that. And I'm going to make two bisecting lines that come down here to a point that is just under, it's four, I don't even know. What is going on? Is everybody okay out there? Are you guys okay? I'm having a moment. Sometimes you have a moment. I'm going to have another sippy sippy. My Pikachu had some. I don't know. I need to evolve or something in Pokemon land. You guys can do this.
I think we can. I think we can get it.
We're going to put two circles in. These are quarter-sized circles. You could probably even get a quarter up there. They're right just below the top grill line and halfway between. I'm going to make another little set of circles. See? And once I know where that is, it's easy for me to put in this little smaller circle. And then directly above that is this weird little reflector, which John probably knows what it's for. Oh my goodness, we drew a
turn signal?
Is that what that is?
I think it's a turn signal.
Sure.
You know, let people know when you're going to make those right-hand turns.
Who knew? If 1945, did they have those? I don't know. Is anyone enjoying this lesson today?
I don't know. I think everybody's enjoying this lesson out here.
I don't know what I'm doing today. I don't know what I'm doing today.
What's your sippy sippy? We should see some more of your sippy sippy.
My Elmer cup.
Your cutie Elmer cup.
My cute Elmer. It's my biggie. When things are...
I think we got it.
We're going to get this truck.
We're going
to
get it.
I want you guys
to
have the best trucks anybody ever had, which is why I'm taking the time to explain drawing this in, because I want you guys to have this truck. It was a lot of fun to paint.
Yeah?
So back to what I was doing earlier with my filbert, my one-inch filbert.
Your filbert. Okay, so now we're actually back to the painting part.
Oh, I'm going to annotate there when we put this thing back up and be like, don't click out.
No, people are saying that they're loving it. They're, you know, we may be technically fumbling through this, but luckily there's that, you know, 30% fast forward button you can push if you're really worried about it.
Yeah. Yeah. And Janine Moran made a good recommendation. If you want to fast forward through what I'm saying, but you don't want to miss any of the technical stuff, she said do it like at the slow speed.
Neat.
Yeah. I was like, that's a good tip. It's so weird when you're not even insulted when someone's talking about, like, shutting you up. You're like, yeah, yeah, shut me up anytime you need to. I'm going to paint in my burnt sienna and my phthalo blue. This is a very dark color. In my fine art practice, I love this combo for skies. I think that...
Why don't you pull it close up over there?
Thank you.
Yeah. And we are, we're in, yeah, you can probably zoom in a little bit more and then pull over. There you go. Whoosh.
Very,
it's because it goes the opposite way that you think it should.
And I'm dyslexic, so that's always fun. So I'm covering this up. Now, as I'm painting this, I'm going to talk about some things you might run into as a new painter. You might be painting this and going, it's like I'm painting and nothing's happening. You'll be having this experience where you're painting and there's no paint going on the canvas. It's either that you don't have enough moisture on your brush, enough paint on your brush, and it can sometimes be that these coatings go off on these canvases.
Yeah.
And it's like that the gesso wasn't a good gesso. So, but it's very rarely the artist. When I'm troubleshooting live with people, it's so very rarely the artist. I can actually think of a handful of times it was the artist. It's pretty much almost always the materials.
Yeah.
Which is the only reason I ever encourage upgrading paint, because I respect people's budgets totally. Totally, totally, totally. It's just sometimes the paints give you so much grief. So we got that painted in. Get a little moisture on my brush. Come over and get a little phthalo blue. We have any questions? Anything to answer?
There's been an ongoing conversation saying that they enjoy the real nature of our show. Your close-up camera. You know, we don't really try to hide the fact that, well, you know, there's a wish right there we're about to paint over. But they like the fact that this is a real show and we're not, you know, trying to hide that we're, you know, have dogs barking in the background or people mowing our yards. So
how would we hide it?
Yeah, it's you definitely get to see how the sausage is made.
Yeah. Yeah, who's that guy that you like so much? He's got that workout plan you like so much.
Joe Rogan?
Joe Rogan. It's not Joe Rogan. It's the other guy. Mike Rowe.
Oh, Mike Rowe. Yeah.
Yeah, cool. I guess I feel like they should be friends. Anyways.
They probably are friends.
They probably are.
Them and Zifrank probably all hang out and like have very witty conversations about koalas.
I'm sorry for those of you who are like, you're talking about celebrities again. But.
Shh.
But I would love to see Joe Rogan and Zifrank and Mike Rowe all in a room. That would be like my fantasy football of like dinner conversations. Okay. I'm going to paint down by the tires now.
Can you pull the camera down there?
Up close cam. Are you there? Ooh, that's some reality, isn't it?
There's more wishes.
We're going to be painting over some more wishes, and when we paint over them, they come true. When we paint over a wish, it comes true.
What are you doing? There's your paint.
When we paint over a wish, it comes true.
We fill the wish with paint.
Oh, my goodness. I'm just putting this coat in. So I've got a nice amount of water and a nice amount of paint on my brush. The consistency that I'm going for, I like to think of as like about that of olive oil or an oil. And this is how you take a heavy-bodied paint to a flow paint consistency. And that's another reason why sometimes having a higher grade of paint helps, because then the binders don't break down as you add water.
Ah, yeah.
Things I'm learning about. Going to the art materials show.
You keep spooking me out. I think you're going to leave the canvas there.
Nausea cam. What are they doing to you? I don't know what's going on today. Does anyone know what's happening today?
I think it's a funny day.
It's a funny day. I don't know if you guys ever have funny days. I think it's that you just came, you know, traveling and...
I just paratroopered back in.
You paratroopered back in and we're like, we're going live. We don't know what's happening. I was a little under the weather yesterday.
Yeah.
I'm better now. It was like the weirdest flu. It was the strangest, craziest flu.
Yeah, Kathy was just asking if I can go back and read all the questions in all the comments afterwards.
Oh, I wish.
Yeah, it actually only lets us see about, I don't know, probably 100 comments back, maybe 50 comments back. So we can only see like the last, you know, maybe 10 minutes of the conversation, depending on how much you guys are chatting in the log. So
that's why it's so nice when it's wonderful when you comment during the broadcast. It really helps us.
Oh yeah.
It also helps us after though, when you guys comment, because those are the comments that other people can see.
Yeah. So please,
and you're going to need to tell them, do this lesson, believe in her. She knows what she's doing. You guys need to get in there and be like, no, she knows what's going on. It's all crazy in the beginning, but it'll be okay in the end.
Oh, yeah.
Because strange people are going to be like, what's happening? What's going on? I need a sippy sippy.
That's a good sippy sippy. And while you're sippy sippying, we'll wish everyone out there who's being affected by the hurricane best wishes and hope that their inner tubes stay connected. So
A hurricane?
There's a hurricane.
I'm gonna wish for hurricane safety.
Hurricane safety.
We get hit by hurricanes, and I just wish everybody is safe and unharmed, and that your property's okay.
Yeah.
Those hurricanes are scary. I know that's, I mean, like, it's what I can do. I can wish on a canvas.
We do.
We do. We do.
And if we all wish together.
That everybody in the hurricane is safe and okay.
Everyone is good.
Yeah, I definitely wish that.
The hurricane just blows out to sea.
Yes. It's just fine. Oh my goodness, that's scary. I didn't know there was a hurricane going on.
Yep. It's on the, to the eastern seaboard.
Don't click away.
That's what we're painting.
We're painting this. Don't click away.
A dead Ford.
Stay. Stay.
And I heckle the Fords. They're good. Yeah, they're good trucks. You know,
I mean,
they're
not a Chevy. I may include a link to it. Listen, if you guys don't think to go see Lindsay's Sheep, I may include a link to Lindsay's Sheep in the iCard after, because it was really cute. It would go super good with this truck. We did not plan. This happens on YouTube all the time, where we all just get up one day like lemurs.
Yep.
And go, farms today? Farms! Chickens. And nobody's talked to each other, and we all just paint farms. Nobody's copying anybody. Nobody's messing with anybody. It's just literally the consciousness of YouTube goes out.
Yep.
And all the YouTubers wake up and think, farms today.
We should do some more farms. Maybe this
weekend.
Honestly,
this is really cute. I like this with the hat.
I do too. A lot of people like the hat. The hat is a big, big success out there.
I have to thank my husband for the hat.
Why?
Because this is a loot crate hat.
It's your hat.
It's a loot crate hat, and my husband is the fan of loot crates. I'm going to get some dogs eating purple and some burnt sienna. We'll pull a little dogs eating purple out and a little burnt sienna.
No, we've got 65 people watching with us right
65
now.
65 people
I know, it's crazy.
Watching today?
You going to zoom in on that?
Yeah, I am. Don't click away, we'll zoom.
Oh, everyone's sticking in here.
Everyone's sticking in. I know everybody in the Breakfast Club and everybody in the Heart Party community, like the hardest that know. They know, like, it's going to work out in the end. Right? We're like Shakespeare in Love up in here. Everything will be okay in the end, and a wonderful painting is going to come out. I just worry about new people who wander in and are like, what is this?
This is crazy painting stuff.
This is crazy painting stuff.
We're going to explore your heart.
We are. Your heart, your art, it's all under wraps here.
Yeah.
I'm just painting this in. This is what we call an underpainting.
And what's the goal of an underpainting?
An underpainting creates blocking or object placement, sometimes tonal values. Also gets a layer of paint on the canvas so all the finishing work can pull it together.
Oh.
And it is one of the many, many ways of laying in a canvas. And do you know what you never do in oils?
No.
An underpainting in this method.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So oil painting and acrylic painting is not alike.
Well, yeah, I thought that just from the mediums. But.
No, and a lot of oil painters will come in and try to paint acrylics like their oils, and a lot of acrylic painters will try to paint oils like their acrylics. And actually, the order of operations, the way these paints perform and lay in, does not allow for, you can obviously switch back and forth, but it really is different.
Yeah.
They're not the same in how they go over. Like, as an oil painter or a watercolorist, you need to have a much better plan for whatever you think is happening here than an acrylic painter has to have. Like, sometimes you'll see me here, like, I don't really have a plan, but I'm not that worried about it. It's because I'm an acrylic artist. I don't have to be worried about it. When I do a watercolor, I'm freaking out like everybody else because I'm like, oh, I don't know what's happening here. Because it matters. But in acrylic paint, you can paint light over dark, you can paint dark over light, it dries fast enough where you get so much forgiveness and the pigment loads are heavy and the way it performs. The forgiveness of acrylic paint, once you get used to this crazy fast drying time, makes it one of the best mediums to just play in a relaxed process.
That's just because the medium itself is that forgiving?
It's so forgiving. Let me tell you what's not forgiving. Watercolor is not forgiving. I've been doing watercolor and periscope just to get back into that process and understand how to explain the difference. You know, on a more refreshed way about watercolor and acrylic, and I have to tell you, not the same.
You have to zoom out and adjust the close-up camera there a little bit, because we're not getting the whole thing.
You want me to zoom out a little bit?
Just a little bit. Well, that's in.
Ooh, go. That's really fun, though. I like that.
You're gonna mess with people.
I will go out. I'm sorry. I'm just having a good time. You know what? If we ever had a camera operator in here, it might be different, but we don't, so I'm zooming in and out today. And I think you can paint in all mediums. I can certainly paint in watercolor, right? And I can certainly paint in oils or pastels or pencils, but it's just knowing that these mediums require different things to perform. And the different, it's really order of operations is what it is.
Yeah.
You know, do you guys remember that from math, the order of operations? Like, it really matters sometimes the order in which you solve an equation. Well, painting is a bit like that. Hmm. In watercolor, you can't paint your darks first. That's not going to work out at all. That's called gouache. So, just saying. Now, I'm going to come in here. I'm going to do an interesting thing. I'm still in my purple. I'm going to also zoom into my little one of my tires.
Okay.
Right? I'm going to get my brown and my purple and I'm going a little bit of blue. And I'm making a very deep, dark color here. And I'm going to paint this part of the tire, this deep, deep, dark color. Just paint this all in the underpainting. Just paint this all in. This is going to be about, I expect to be here pretty close on 2 hours for this painting.
Yep.
I do today. Doing this with you.
But we're doing pretty good. We got 67 people out here hanging out, watching us.
I so appreciate how you guys have been sharing. I see that stuff out on social media that you guys share and tweet the stuff out and post it on Facebook and put it on Instagram and Pinterest. I so appreciate the community doing that. It is incredible. I'm going to come over to my other tire.
Well, I love that we have the community here with us. It's what makes it fun to do and record.
It really does. I mean, it makes them just a scotch longer. I think they run about 20 minutes longer because I get to chatting with you guys. But
we like it.
I like it.
You can do the 20% fast forward button.
20% fast forward button.
And now you are working.
I'm not offended. I'm really not.
You are working in acrylics, though, right?
Yes.
These are not oils.
These are not oils, and you would not want to lay in an oil painting like this. I would not paint this truck this way in oils at all.
Right. That's looking pretty good.
I would never block in an oil painting this way either.
So, now why are you painting the tires blue instead of black?
This will feel like black when it's all done, and the reason I tend not to use that much black in my painting is it grays or dulls out the chroma or the paint.
Huh.
Takes away some of the depth and beauty of the color, and I'm not a fan of it. I know a lot of artists are. We certainly love to get in heated debates about using black or not in a painting, and I'm just not a fan.
Interesting.
So I just don't do it.
Don't do it.
I don't do it. I'm going to come up here. I'm going to get these sort of painted in. Sometimes if you know what's going on, like I've done this painting, you know, a couple of times. Well, this will be the second time. So one time. But I, in the designing of it, in the creating of it, which I did on Periscope. Sometimes I do these little things on Periscope. Sometimes I design on Periscope. But I'm trying to make Periscope a place where I do stuff I don't do on Heart Party. I am. To have it be different than the YouTube channel. It's more like I'm going to just goof around, listen to music and paint. And there's no instruction on Periscope at all.
So Lindsay was saying that, sorry, I got distracted reading the comments over there. Mm. Earlier, she's saying she likes to clean her studio while she's watching you do live broadcasts. And she just said that it'd be fun. You're inspiring her to want to go do one too.
Oh, you told, I'm so sorry I missed your live broadcast. You have to let me know when you're doing the next one because I want to be in it. I want to be, like, commenting.
Definitely. We will definitely come by.
I am not, however, going to clean my studio.
That's kind of my job.
Just, It's probably not happening, though I need to. I need to clean my studio. I'm so glad so many of the YouTubers are embracing live.
I like it.
And I don't know if Lindsay's ever going to hop on Periscope, but if she does, I'll be her Periscope buddy. I'm really liking Periscope. It's a great place to do stuff you wouldn't do on your YouTube channel. It really is.
You're doing okay there. Oh, you're on to the side.
Yeah, I'm going over here. So I like that. But guys, if you're not on Periscope, don't feel like you're missing any instruction. That's not what's happening on Periscope.
Goofing off.
Goofing is happening on Periscope. Me messing around with watercolors, or I think right now I'm working on kids' faces because that's an area. I want to cover some faces later, and I need to get back into the anatomy of the face. So working on the kids' faces right now because they're crazy. I keep aging my kids up. Been talking about this with John lately, is I age those kids up. So the pictures of a four-year-old, but I add just enough length to the bridge of the nose and the cheekbones to make them seven. it's like I'm that FBI artist who's like, and in 5 years this kid will look like this.
So that bracelet you're wearing, did you make that?
Mm-mm.
No,
I purchased it.
You
It was super sparkly.
You'll go over to the close-up camera with it.
Okay.
Oh, there it goes.
Isn't that pretty?
It's a big chunk of amethyst.
Yeah.
And it's set silver.
Almost like a druzy.
Yeah.
And, yeah, I like it.
So
I bought it at a boutique.
Lindsay said that you could be on, she had a, where did it, let me scroll back up because I don't want to miss what it was. You can be on Ask a Crafter with her. I'm not sure what.
I will so be on Ask a Crafter. I would do that. That would be so fun. That is awesome.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Straight up. Totally there. Same, total Bat time, total Bat channel. I'm there.
We got it?
Yeah. All right. I'm wearing my Batman. I don't know.
You are wearing Batman.
I'm wearing my Batman.
You kind of just geeked out today.
I'm a little geeked out today. Yep. I don't know if you guys ever have days like that where you're a little geeked out. I'm a little geeked out. First of all, Heroes Reborn. Bam! Love
that was great.
I don't really know how they're going to get Claire off that Nashville show. The whole time I'm watching this show, I'm just wishing they would get Claire off Nashville so she can come back and be a indestructible cheerleader and save the world.
You put the put your close-up camera back on.
I just don't even care about Nashville at all. I'm just like, how do we get Claire off Nashville? I know it's so funny. It's like that actress's name is not even Claire. But as far as I'm concerned, she's Claire Bennett, and we need to put her in a cheerleader skirt and set her on fire periodically.
There you go.
And have her like walk out like, no, I cannot be burned. Also, I just don't even buy that she's dead. That's just it's not a reality. I've watched all the Heroes and Back Heroes, and I'm just saying. And this new guy is not the new Siler, I'll tell you that right now.
Oh yeah?
No. But I'm excited. I'm ready for Hiro, who's my favorite character, to come back.
Hiro Nakamura.
Yeah, I'm more into his daughter than I think you are.
I thought it was okay. Yeah, it was, you know, we'll have to see how it evolves.
I think you weren't happy with the choreography.
I was thinking, you know, there was some definitely falling short of Kill Bill moments in there, but you know.
Which was also awesome.
But, you know, you kind of felt like the lobby sequence was supposed to be more, you know, Kill Bill-ish.
You did?
I think that's what they were going for.
Okay.
It just, you know.
I'm just so excited to be back in Hero Land, you know. I just needed that back. I'll tell you what, I'm surprised. We were just at the movies. We just went and saw the Scorch Trials.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Maze Runner 2.
Yep, which we're not going to do any spoilers, don't worry. But they had this preview for this upcoming remake of a movie. And it was Point Break.
Oh, yeah.
That's the movie that needs to be remade, is Point Break. We don't feel like Keanu Reeves and Patrick Swayze cover that story well enough.
We had to retell it.
We have to retell it, man.
I think it's awesome.
John's actually... I don't know. I think that's some kind of guy movie. So, painting. We also teach that here.
Now you're just blocking in.
I'm just blocking this in with that same dark color, and we're just telling, we just want to make sure that these things are here. Once it's blocked in, then the rest of this painting comes together very easily and very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And there's just no point in moving on to another color of something until we've like totally blocked this in where it can be.
What are you zooming in on?
I think the windows.
The window?
Oh. Yeah.
Just blocking in some of that over the top of the hood there.
Yeah. That's so very cool. Love and life. Relaxing now that I'm painting. It's so weird. Like sometimes I'll come in here and be like a little tense, a little stressed out, and get to painting with you guys, and then I feel better.
Yep.
So sometimes y'all are my therapy, just so you know.
Everybody needs a little therapy.
Everybody. And at the cost of therapy these days, a little cheap therapy online is not a bad idea.
Well, if we find, you know, it's the our community is our tribe, and we like to talk with our tribe.
Yeah. I am blown away and humbled by the people who give me 2 hours of their day to paint with me. It just is mind-boggling.
Yeah, thank you guys for joining us. Without you guys being here watching us, it would not be as much fun at all.
Also, it would be weird.
Yeah, it would be.
That we're just here painting.
Very,
and I'm watching.
Very weird.
Very strange. Okay, so I'm going to add some of this. I'm going to come here and I'm going to just...
Where are you going?
I'm going to make sure that I've put in this line a little bit. I want to know where it is. And then I'm going to come over. There it is. There. Okay. I'm going to come over.
There.
The other day. So Periscope doesn't have music recognition, John.
Well, someday it will.
Someday it will, but currently it does not, which means I can put on my jams and paint, which is really nice for me because that's what I like to do. But I realized I have these weird like moments. Like I was doing this kawaii macaroon cat.
Yeah.
It's kind of tokidoki thing. For the girls.
Mm-hmm.
And I had like Sesame Street on in the background.
That's awesome.
Just sunny day, everything's a-okay. Ooh, I'm going to get a comment about that. All right. So now I'm going to get some more tire in. Let's come down the tires. I know this is like.
There they are. Tires.
What is it? One of these. Oh, there. It's one of these strings.
It's okay. We're working it out.
So I'm going to put in a little more blue here. A little more blue. And I'm going to add a little white to this now. And I'm going to just paint in my bumper.
I thought you were painting tires.
I am going to paint in tires too.
Well, then you should aim the
closer
camera at your bumper.
Yeah. I don't know what happens. You know what I mean? Sometimes I get lost.
Sometimes you just, you know what?
I guess today I'm that guide that's a little...
It's a moving target.
It's a little befuddled up there in the National Forest going, I don't know, there's a tree over here I like. There's a tree over here I like. For sure. I'm so sorry we didn't get the pre-show going.
Yeah, we have to. We'll try again next time where we can come up online and try getting our audio dialed in the live pre-show.
Yeah. But
I have to say that every show we've gotten closer and closer.
I mean, by next year, we're going to be all over this. I just keep thinking any day now. And it's just the two of us today. Sometimes we get to have friends and like Claire or Margaret that give us a hand.
Yeah.
Which is pretty cool. And we have been making this like incredible noise about somehow figuring out how to get a camper and getting all the stuff in a camper.
Yep.
I don't know if that's a good plan or a bad plan.
It's a plan.
It's a plan. We'll find out if my gypsy artist fantasy thing was a good idea or a bad idea.
Yeah. I think it'd be cool to get a, you know, a nice little pull behind bumper pole that we can just go jump on the road and go visit people.
Oh, that'd be amazing. And like just go paint the Lost Maples Park or
paint it.
Go to the Painted Desert and paint things live.
Yep.
I mean, I'm not trying to be Steven Baughman here. You know, I don't want to be eaten by like a mountain lion. I'm not saying that he's going to be eaten by a mountain lion. I wish him light and love. I think he's one of my favorite artists. I'm just saying he gets so remote that I start to worry about the mountain lion a little bit.
Yeah.
But he looks tough. So I'm sure he'll be okay. I like want to take one of his workshops. But again, mountain lion problems. Mountain lion problems. I just like, I really want to, I really enjoy it. But I don't want to be eaten.
We should stay in like, you know, parks.
Yeah.
We could go places where people can paint with us.
I need to stop watching the Discovery Channel is what it is.
Yeah. We could paint in every state.
Oh, that would be amazing. The 50 state tour.
And then we can go abroad.
And then we go abroad. I would love that. Then Clive can be really upset because I'll show up at his house. We're like, people need to stop showing up. No, I won't. I will absolutely call first.
Indeed.
Absolutely will call first. All my European friends before I just dropped in. Yeah, I would love that. I'd love to go back to France again and paint.
Mm-hmm. That'd be fun.
Oh, it'd be amazing. I'd love to go to Ireland and paint.
Oh, yeah.
We haven't been to Ireland since we were really young.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to go back. It is very cool to be artistic in Ireland. No joke. They like it.
They do. What are you doing?
All right.
Now is the time for the tire?
Now is the time for the tire.
All right.
All right. You're like, I just need the tire to get
painted. I'm good for any. Don't
He's
paint
like,
tire.
Just paint the tire.
I just think it's funny that you're like, all right, we're going to paint the tire, and then you paint the bumper.
Yeah. Oh, that's way too purple. Rinse that out. If that ever happens to you, like you've just overloaded a pigment, just rinse it out and start over. It happens.
Too much
of one pigment can happen to anyone. And then just a little bit of purple. I'm just trying to get this sort of grayed out color.
There's a list of probably 10 people, maybe more here, that are saying that they would love to see you just come by their area.
It would be so much fun. I would just absolutely go visit my favorite YouTubers, all my YouTube friends.
Mm-hmm.
And now I have, you know, man, YouTube is really, I have to say, here's my feeling on YouTubers. Are you ready for this, John?
Yep.
I love them. The lion's share of people on YouTube really do this because their heart's in it. And they're super fun and exciting to talk to. I mean, like going to Creator Day was really cool because even though there were people with very different channels than my own, you know,
yeah,
we all had this sort of passion about what we were doing that was very exciting to share. Very exciting to share. It was uncommon to run into a YouTuber that was not in it for a heart reason.
Yeah.
And it happens. Now I'm gonna brush stroke down. This is an implied stroke. I'm gonna let the sort of streak down. And you're like, but that tire is so purple. But believe you me, by the time it's all done, it's gonna read as a whole nother color, which is what I love about painting.
You gonna put the camera on that one too?
Yeah, I am.
That'd be good.
No, you she can.
There you go.
Things we'll be sorry about in branding later.
Yeah.
What, 10 years from now we're like, Nausea Cam. Have a little barfy graphic. I don't know. Does anyone like the new graphic? Chuck's new graphic for the Sherpa? Did anyone notice that?
We have the new hat. I'll bring it up here on the top on the main one.
I just have to thank Chuck Carson for that.
It was awesome. Let me pull it up.
He's just incredible.
There it is. Yeah, turn around, look. You take a sippy sippy.
Thank you, Chuck.
Thank you, Chuck. Check out the new hat. We like the hat.
It is bananas. B-A-N-A-N-A-S. I don't know why that keeps happening to me.
Because you're having fun. Because
I'm having fun. I should be teaching this lesson.
Which you are doing.
I'm putting this in. I'm going to get a shorter bristled half-inch filbert because this soft, long bristle is taking me too long to get through stuff. And I'm going to come and pull out some just burnt sienna, and I'm going to add a scotch, a smidge, a small amount of phthalo blue to it to darken it. Here's the good news, guys. Rust is the funnest, easiest thing in the world to paint.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Why is that?
It's really about dry brushing. So all you got to do is get your dry brush down and break up your color spectrum, and stuff is going to look rusty. So this technique will get you through your robot. It'll get you through any of your rusted metal items.
So are you going to show how to do the dry brushing here?
No. Right now I'm going to block it in. I'm just trying to get them excited so they'll stay on.
Well, if you are staying on, you should click to like, comment, and subscribe. That way YouTube knows that you were here.
Yes,
and
please.
That we should keep doing this.
Yes.
And really, honestly, we do appreciate the comments. They let the other fan, our other community members know, what's going
happening.
On. And that you guys liked this, and that the video is worth hanging out for.
So they'll hang in and give themselves a chance to do the painting.
Yeah. You gonna pull your close-up camera there
I
up
am.
A little bit?
Yeah. Gonna do that. Thank you. And see, I love having John in here because I would paint like 30 minutes and forget my close-up cam. It is harder to do this than you think, guys. To paint and talk is much harder than painting and chewing bubble gum.
You would think.
But it is really hard to paint and talk because of the Bob Ross effect.
Yeah, you kind of want to just go numb.
You do. You just get in a meditative state and you start to relax. I relax as much as you guys do. And then all of a sudden I have a happy little truck with a lovely little brown. And you do. You just go there.
Just blah.
You just go. Your brain just flatlines. And you're like, I'm so happy. Which is, I think, why kids know coloring is an important part of their day.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I imagine so.
I think so. My daughter Luna takes her color time seriously.
Oh, yeah.
It's serious. It's just a really serious three-year-old with the coloring. Just like, relax, Luna. And she's like, shh, I'm thinking. Just don't touch her stuff. You're allowed to be with her when she paints, but she used to want me to paint with her. Now she just wants me to witness her painting. But don't touch it, because she's working. And then the other day she was like, don't touch my pens.
Oh, yeah.
They're mine, and I can do it.
She got it.
She's like, she showed me how she could take the caps on and off. She's like, I'm good at it. Don't touch my stuff. And I was like, wow. But she touches my stuff.
Yes.
All the time she's touching my stuff, getting my art supplies. Paint pens. She's like, these are just markers waiting for me to color with.
On my walls.
On the walls with the permanent acrylic paint pens. That's always awesome.
It's really great.
And my son will color, but he'll only color those Color Alive and Quiver coloring pages, the 3D pages.
He seems to like those, though.
He loves those. If you have a kid that is not really into coloring, they may really like those. No, it's not a sponsor video. We just have both those apps in the house. And my son is not as into coloring, but he's gotten into art and sharing that time with me a lot more now that he has the Color Alive stuff and the Quiver stuff.
Maricha just joined us.
He prefers if it does something, though. I've noticed that's his thing. He wants it to be very interactive when he's done. Like, it needs to explode or do something.
Nice. Yeah, I was going to say, Maricha just jumped in here.
Maricha! Hello, Maricha.
All sorts of nice people joining us today.
I love that. I know it's taking a long time to block this one in.
But this is the part. This is the big part. Is getting all this base color in there.
It really is. This is much closer to, say, if we were to do a street scene or an architectural painting. This is a lot of how this goes. I used to be my mom's studio assistant. Do you remember those days, John?
I do.
Remember the days of studio assistant? So it was my job to clean up, clean caps, wash brushes, do the underpainting, sketch the stuff in, and then also get up at the crack of dawn for photography. and hoof it out into the, the streets in the morning, trying to catch morning light. Which was really good for me.
Mm-hmm.
That was a good time for me. I learned a lot. I also ran the Giclée printer and did printing, so that's how I learned a lot about Pantone and what was going on and where I got my art business education.
Yeah.
It's where I got my art business education. It's why I'm so sharky. But not really. But I know what the sharks are up to, I guess would be more accurately it.
Yeah.
You know what the sharks are up to. I've swum with them. And why on occasion I say crazy stuff like, and when we saw Thomas Kincaid, or when we saw Jane Seymour.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because she'd go to Art Expo and do stuff. With her, before her open heart penance, she had some paintings. And she was hoofing around.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, like, I'm all for skinny, but Hollywood skinny is another level of skinny.
Yeah.
It's like another level. As a tiny, tiny, thin, real thin woman. Not unhealthy. I'm not saying that. Just impossibly small. That was sort of interesting. Seeing people there. We were just coming around. You remember my mom's agent?
Mm.
Gilles?
Yeah.
Gilles.
He loved everything.
He loved everything. He's French and he loved everything. That was really good times. So see, I'm just getting this in. And I think we're seeing, you can see, there's sort of streaky brush strokes, like the brush strokes of the filbert. They're in here. And honestly, at this stage, it's in my benefit. This adds character to what I'm doing. So I don't push against it at all.
Yeah.
In any way. It's a good idea, and I want it in there, and I'm not stressing out. So if you guys are sitting there going, how do I get rid of these brush strokes? It may not even be necessary if you're doing a painting with several layers. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I'm going to add a little more blue to this. It's still brown, but it's going to be darker. Not quite the blue of the window and the thing, but it's going to be dark, dark, dark. And the reason I have it be a different tone or value than this here is just so I can tell these two zones apart.
Gotcha.
You just want to make sure that what you're mixing here is darker than the rust you're going to be putting on it, but is of enough of a different tone or value. Even if you have to, sometimes I'll do something like, well, I'll grab some just burnt sienna, and just here at this line where they meet, I just make sure that I have just enough value difference to not lose my line. And it may be small, but it will matter later. It will matter later. All right. So sometimes that's a little planning thing that you can do, but you need a lot more planning than that for oil painting. Tell you that right now, more than just a little value difference. So it's still pretty forgiving. A little bit of value that you've got to drop here, nothing. And so you see, you just sort of tell that roof from those hubcaps just a little bit.
Yeah,
that's all you need. It's not a big difference, it's just enough of a difference. Now that's what I am working on. Pretty excited about. I have the programming plan for like through Christmas. I got in and made sure my programming is planned through Christmas.
Ooh, very good.
So we have a plan. I mean, we might change the plan.
The plan may evolve.
Just saying. I got a plan. I need a fresh cup of coffee.
Ooh, I will see about getting you one.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Does anyone mind if I get a fresh cup of coffee? You guys can certainly absolutely fast forward through my fresh cup of coffee, but I think I need one. I go here. Okay, I'm on that one. Good. So yeah, this is all I'm putting in. John's gave me a fresh cup of coffee. Hopefully the coffee pot has not been turned off. Everyone is like decided to conserve water. I mean, not conserve water, but conserve electricity just with the coffee pot. Right, they just keep turning it off to save electricity. And I'm like, that's the one appliance I'm willing to splurge on being on. Took Elmer. Oh, while we're here, I can't see your comments, but I want to share something with you. I don't know if you saw it on Periscope, but I covered cleaning acrylic brushes. And we're going to try to put a nice high-end one like the palette, the wet palette and stuff like that on here. But this is my brush cleaner. You guys keep asking me, how do I get my gloss, medium, and varnish out of my brush? This is the cleaner that I use. Can you guys really see this? There are better, more expensive cleaners out there, but I've used this forever and ever. Doesn't has a pretty good smell. It's not as good as the artist's hand soap for smell, the one that smells like gum, which also does this. But this one has a cleaner and preservative in it, so you can reshape your brushes easily and wash them out. That's what I use, and I'll probably throw up my periscope of me washing some brushes on my Facebook page today, I think. That's what I'll be doing. I can hear him making coffee. Don't click away. Just fast forward through it. Go. You're like, I don't know what she's doing. Yeah, that's just. Let's all dance. It's dancey dance time. John's gonna get in and read these comments and was like, what were you doing with the community? Ooh, Elmer's full. Did you add agave?
I did. Is there enough?
It's really sweet.
Oh, it's just agave. Sorry.
Oh, the creamer has sugar in it.
Oh, just a little bit.
Things you might not know that now you know.
I do.
I sweeten with agave. Sherpa trivia. Super fast. Just kidding. So I have that. I've got one thing left to block in.
Lori's husband said that he thought that the way that you approached painting, that he might even be willing to jump in himself.
Wow.
We'll have to see how that goes. That would be very cool.
Or are you going to post and share on my Facebook?
Yes, definitely show the picture. We would love to see it. Post those pictures up. I love seeing everything that you guys do.
We're on Instagram.
Yep.
You can share there. We're on Twitter. And you can share there. We're on Facebook. Definitely share there. And you get polled and stuff there. You have lots of power on Facebook. And we're on Pinterest.
All the different places.
So all those places. So wherever is convenient for you to share, just share. I'm going to add a little purple to my red. Maybe I'm going to add a little blue too. This will take it to a brick color.
That's cool.
Yeah. Cad red and phthalo blue makes a brick color.
Huh.
It's because this is the green shade and this is the orange shade, and green and orange are contrast colors. Which is why you can't get purple with cadmium red and phthalo blue, even though red and blue make purple.
Yep.
These two do not. Because they're contrasts. They're hidden contrasts. That happens to people a lot when they're painting. They get tagged with hidden contrasts.
Mm-hmm.
That they don't know the paint colors are secretly contrasting colors. And they're like, why can't I mix colors like everybody else? And they don't realize it's just the undertone in the paint, which is why the color wheel is so very interesting. All right, look at that. We're blocked in.
Looking good.
It finally happened. I'm so excited to be blocked in. Switching out paint. How did everybody hang in while I was like losing my mind on the sippy sippy?
I think they thought it was cute.
Okay. Stuff you do.
Sippy, sippy. They thought the coffee was good.
Mm.
Coffee equals love.
Coffee does equal love. Absolutely. Straight up in the universe, coffee equals love.
And a lot of people like your bracelet today.
Bracelet. I liked it too. I treated myself. I did. It was a treat myself. It's when you call your husband up and you're like, you're buying me a present. You're so sweet. I love you so much.
That was the sweetest gift. I didn't know I got her.
He buys me a lot of these presents. So sometimes I will be looking through my brushes. Here's a little art thing that I go through. I'll look through my brushes and I'm feeling for a flick. And in dry brushing, I want a stiffer brush is what I want. Not even as much as I care about it being a filbert or bright or any of that. I'm looking for a very stiff bristle. And this happens to be a very stiff bristle.
Yep.
So I'm going to get that, and I'm going to pull out a little of my dog's ink purple.
Can you push that forward out there, the canvas? Yeah, oh, there it goes. Now we can see it all again.
I get a little of my dog's ink purple, and I'm going to go get its contrast. I mean, I just said that backwards. I'm so dyslexic. I got a little of my yellow ochre, and I'm going to take a little of my dioxazine purple. Yellow and purple are contrasts on the color wheel. So if you ever need to knock back or gray out a paint color because it's too bright, instead of going to the black, go to its contrast color on the wheel and you can create these beautiful muted designer colors. Right?
Oh, yeah.
So this brush is very dry. I didn't put any water on it. Okay? Okay.
Throw your right tassel.
And I'm going to...
It's your right tassel.
Am I here? Here. Okay, go.
For your microphone.
It was what?
Your microphone tassel. There you go.
And I'm going to just start dry brushing around here, over what's here, in this sort of kind of... I don't know. What would you call this pattern, John? I'm just sort of blocking it.
Yeah, it's really just sort of roughing in the shape. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not making curved strokes. I'm making straight strokes, and I kind of crosshatch them. And that's what I'm doing. Pull on a little more. If you need a little more purple, get it. Gray it back. Gray it back. And I am light over the canvas. I'm going to really zoom in on this, if I can. Can I really zoom?
You are pretty zoomed in.
Right here. I'm going to really zoom in.
You're just wanting to screw around now.
No. I have a point.
Okay.
So I'm going to do it down here. This pressure is very light pressure. And the paint, right?
Yeah.
Is very dry. So it's going to skip over my canvas. It's not going to go into the cracks of the tooth, right?
Yep.
It's going to stay on the surface of the tooth. And by lightly brushing across the top of the tooth, the canvas can pick up bits of this. I'm just saying this because it's just super important to creating this rust effect.
Because you want the...
I want the paint to show through.
Yeah.
In rust, often on these old trucks, you see layers and layers and layers of paint showing through. So that's how I get this. Things that can give you grief when you're trying to do this, guys, is that on some of the student grade paints or some of the craft paints, because they're soft bodied... They're a soft-bodied paint, and because they're soft-bodied, they will sometimes not do a nice dry brush. But there's a fix for that, which is make sure the brush you're painting with is very dry, scrumble them off on a towel so there's less paint on there, and paint with light pressure. That's how you fix for student paint. And I feel like I have some here. I could probably show it. If anybody wants me to show how I'd fix for student paint.
Well, we can probably do that on the other side.
Okay.
Find.
I keep losing my little thing. If over there in those tubs is some artist loft. That's all the way to the far end. Just pull me that there. Okay, so you guys will be painting with I'm gonna pull out some artist loft. Alright. So say you have some artist loft in yellow ochre. Okay. Artist loft and yellow ochre.
Okay.
I'm going to put out just a small amount. I'm going to show you. Okay. Pigment's going to be a little lower. Right? And already you can see it pulls out wetter than my heavy body. I'm going to pull some dioxazine purple into it to tint it back. So I've got my dry, dry brush. And I am going to tap on my towel. And that is how I still get that same effect, even though that paint, I'll show you a little bit. If I don't do that, it paints a glaze like that. Can you guys see the glaze? Where it doesn't do the nice dry brush.
Yeah, I think you can kind of see the difference there.
Let's see if I can. Yeah, you can see it right there.
Yeah, you can really see the difference.
Yeah. So that's how you do it. You'd have to tap it off on a towel, and I'll work it out here. Okay, and that's how you fix for that. So don't let the paint that you're painting stop you. Don't let the paint that you're painting stop you. Just know that your paint has limits. It has parameters. It has boundaries. And as you understand to work those paint's boundaries is how you can work around what's going on with your paint. Does that help anybody? I don't know if that does. I can go into that more if anybody needs to.
I think everybody seems to be enjoying that.
Oh, okay. I'm going to kind of...
But there's also a secondary track of husband conversations going.
Husband conversations? What's going on with husband conversations?
Well, we're talking about how there are some people who have husbands and some people who want husbands and some people who are very happy without husbands. So, you know.
I'm sticking with you, but after you, I'm done.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. I don't know. I'd re-up.
Just you and me.
Just you and me.
I couldn't do another one, anyone else.
No, I really couldn't. But you're awesome.
In? Could you zoom in on your other one?
I forgot you, didn't I?
There you go. Oh, there we go.
So you can kind of see that coming in. And you can sort of pull this out every once in a while and let them see the overall effect.
I do.
That has this, so there's this deep tone and now there's this rust tone. Right? And I'm gonna pick up my pace so that this isn't a 4-hour lesson. All right, and I'll zoom out just a titch.
There we go. Hey, that's good.
Yeah. No, I just wanted to show that up close because sometimes if people can't see the tooth, they don't know what they're going for, they don't know what to shoot for, they can't do it. Does that make sense?
It does.
So here I am coming along here. I'm okay if a little more purple gets into that scrumble than ochre. And I can even come back with some pure ochre now and get a pop. I just want this underlayment of rust. And this is what this is really going to be, is we're going around here on the car. This is a lot of what we're doing when we're trying to show aging or weathering or crazing. See, because I watch Bronson Pinchot.
Ooh.
On that crazy restoration. What was that restoration Balky thing with Bronson Pinchot?
Or Balky, you mean?
Balky, yeah. Anyone see that? It's just Balky's gone to, I think he's over by Lindsay.
Dude, he's got like the coolest house he's building.
It's just bananas. His whole vision is like and just really off the chain. But I've learned a lot of restoration and thrift store and stuff terminology from him.
Yeah, he does know, like, the proper words for all of the different...
For, like, everything!
Yeah.
See, and I've even gone and got my student paint there, but I'm not worried about it. I'm just going to come over here and keep going. All right. And then do some up on the top. Now, I'm not going to do the whole top. Let me move my thing up. All right. I'm going to just come here. I'm just going to do some places with this on the top because I want there to be a difference between the top of the truck, right?
Yep.
And the bottom. So it might have less of this up here. You know, than you might think. Another interesting thing, we're going to not even rinse this brush out. I want you to just come over and get some just burnt sienna, pick up a smidge of scotch, a small, almost imperceptible amount of the phthalo, because we want it to still be a fairly high rust, we just don't want it to have its full chroma, its full intensity. Make sure you don't have too much paint on there, and start brushing in some of this brown rust here and there. Yeah. Right? You see me doing that?
Oh, yeah.
Not everywhere, just going to start coming in places. This is the fun of this. It's about this layering, this aging. So there's some work. There's some labor in this type of painting. And a lot of times when people want to do these, they don't realize the steps or the labor that goes into. Once you understand this vintage kind of technique, you guys can really go in and paint a lot of different types of things. And you can get very accurate things. If you're not drawers, what I wholly recommend is printing out the vehicle, a picture of the vehicle, and tracing it on the canvas, and then working this out. Don't let your imagination be stopped by your set of skills. Skills will come in time, and your imagination needs to be taken out for a spin. I'm putting it right here. And come here, and this is just what we're doing. placing this around.
And you're using a filbert there?
I'm using the filbert because it was my stiffest bristle brush. What I want people to use is their stiffest bristle brush. Right, that's what I want people to use. If sometimes you get a darker color on your rust, don't worry about it. It's a good thing. If you come back with a dark color again on your rust, don't worry about it. Look, I'm just working that in.
That's looking really good.
It's a good thing. I'm going Martha Stewart on you guys. It's a good thing. You want to break up these colors. So things I'm doing to get a really good effect is I'm avoiding patterns. Hopefully you guys can see how I'm avoiding making patterns, repeating a pattern through the piece. I don't want to do that. All right, and I'm going to come in with a little more of that dark color. I want to put some of that a couple places over here on the other side where I did the dark brown and the blue. Just rusting it up. Rust it up. Now I'm going to do a... What? Where did you go?
I had to put Greta out.
I didn't even know that you did anything. So I'm making quite a dark brown here. And I'm going to come here. Top of the, over this here, and define it a little bit with this darker color and work this up into it. Crazy, right, John? That's what we're doing. Add some right there in the middle. Come here. Scrumbling is acceptable on a rust painting, on a patinaed painting. This is very similar if we were doing old stones. We would do some similar things to this. If we were doing an old house, we would do some similar things to this. So you're picking up. Now I'm going to get some just brown here. I'm going to come in and work my just brown. Working my just brown. Work that just brown in where you need to. And this is really about coming in and just giving it a work. Just give this a work.
That coffee is actually pretty good.
Yeah, it is. Now I've got a nice, stronger amount of brown. Watch me arc it over here on this edge and...
Close up.
Yeah, and you?
Yeah, okay. I got it.
All right. I'm arcing it over here and I'm pulling more of this brown down at the top of the hood. And I'm softly blending it into the hood. Softly blending it into the hood. Now, those of you that got through the fox are feeling fairly confident here.
Yeah.
Probably about what you're doing.
Mona seems to be a little worried.
What is going on, Mona?
She's just doubting herself a little bit. We believe in you.
I've seen your paintings. You got this. There's a hot mess phase to your painting. A patina painting is about hanging in. It's about hanging in. It is about layering. Lots of layers, and is about strengthening and reinforcing lines. Like, see how I'm taking this just brown here and I'm reinforcing this line with this brown, and maybe I'll come in and do a stronger element of that brown. Still not adding any water to my brush though.
Still dry brushing.
Still dry brushing, but this pressure is harder. The paint load is heavier. I'm saying there's thicker elements of paint right up there, right? That's what I'm saying. Now, another thing that I can do is I can come in here, brush still dirty, my yellow and a little of my blue, and I can create this browned out green. Right? Add a little brown to that. Ooh, that's a good one.
Yeah.
And a little white. Top of my hood. Maybe at one time this truck had this sort of color going on. And I'm going to come maybe a little bit around the hubcap there. I'm just keeping this interesting
headlight.
Grayish green. Can everyone see this grayish green? Can we all see it?
I think we can see it.
Now I got a little more white in it there, but do I freak out? No, I add this to the mix.
It just looks cool.
And I'm going to follow along this line and give some paint here. I'm saying, oh, well, this paint did this, but there's some darker green and yellow on my brush. I don't worry about that. I work that in. When Bob kept saying happy accidents, what he really meant is that when you've been painting a long time, certainly unexpected things will happen to you during the journey. But what you learn to do is go, oh, nope, that's good. I'll use that color. You know, you learn to be like, oh, no, I got this. So I'm working these color bits into this here.
You know, you're not doing a lot of sippy today.
I'm not. I'm working, man. This
you're
is
just
painting.
A painty painting.
This is a hard painting. We got to worky worky it. So I've got this sort of gray blue, and I'm working in here. Rusting this truck up. Maybe I need some of this up here, right? I'm going to scrumble some of this up here on the hood, because certainly it would have some of this color, wouldn't it? I'm back into this green. Come here and add some of this right here. Look at that. Just a little bit at this corner. Maybe a little bit at this corner. I don't know what's happening to my sound. Was something happen? Are you drinking my coffee? Just coming and drinking my coffee like my coffee can be just totally pilfered. I'm working that in here. I'm looking for balance is what I'm looking for in this piece. So like I'm feeling like I'm missing some balance there. Watch me get some of just this yellow ochre. I'm gonna come here and go back with just some yellow ochre. Just a couple places. Need it right there.
Just some touch-ups.
Just touching it up. Just look for places where you're like, oh, I could use some balance there. I need some green over on this side. A little brown to that. I'll take some of this darker color at first. I'll come here, maybe right here. Pull that out. Now this will all pop, guys, when we take the orange in here. You're like, wait, orange? Yeah, we're gonna play with some contrast. I'm gonna do this. Let me add some white to this mix. How is everybody doing? Are they panicking and they hanging in with me? Do they believe in their ability to rust a vehicle?
Everybody seems to be. They love how the technique.
Yeah. This is a technique, one that you will use in many things in your paintings. This applies to a bunch of stuff that can happen. And John can even talk about the way paint, these trucks used to be painted like different, these weird coats of paint,
mm-hmm.
and would rust out in different layers of color.
Yeah, well, there's, you know, they used different kinds of steel, much thicker steel, different types of paint that had you know, different, like, leads and
so when they
materials. They just patina very differently.
They do. They patina very differently. And so that's what you're trying to create here. Now, what we're going to tell stories this. We're going to tell the story that the last color this truck was red. Kind of a reddish orange.
Okay.
Put this in here and I'm going to get a good bright. This is it's about a half inch bright and has a nice sharp edge. And that's what I like about my bright is to have a nice sharp edge. And I'm going to come over and I'm going to get a little of my cad red and a little bit of my cad yellow.
It's funny. Someone was commenting that they think that the truck looks like it has a little mold on it.
Yeah.
And it's true. If you've ever gone and looked at an old dead Ford parked under a tree, because there's a lot of them, they generally have mold on them. And that's, you know, that's just because, you know, that they do, you know, old cars grow mold on them. It's just something that happens.
So along my edge, I'm painting this orange that I've created. The brush is still fairly dry and I'm making a nice edge. And I'm going to pull this. Oh, that's too yellow. But again, I'm not going to worry about it. I'm going to pull this orange out here. Right here.
Yeah.
And we're going to start oranging up this truck. Saying its last coat of paint. Last coat of paint.
Was some orangey paint?
with some orange kind of red paint. And that's what we're going to tell the story of.
That looks pretty good.
Come around this edge here, up over this little hump here. I'm going to start pulling this in. Great. And make sure that I don't make real specific patterns, right, that will catch my eye. Because the thing about a pattern is it will catch your eye. Your eye is designed to catch a little pattern. I'll put a little red paint here, but just a bit. Maybe a little bit right here. All right. And there we go. Oh, I'm loving it. Maybe add a little line along this outer edge. We're just painting this today, guys. I don't know what to tell you. I'm into it now. This painting is happening.
Mm-hmm. It's looking good.
I'm into it. All right. I'm going to come along and do something sort of similar on this side. Make a nice crisp edge. I'm going to leave a little of that green there in that corner. See? I left a little bit of my little rust. Just a little bit. Just take this out here. Take this orange out. Look at that.
That looks sharp.
Doesn't that look sharp?
Yeah. Can you pull that up to the canvas so we can just kind of see the...
You want it up to this here?
Yeah. Because it just gets the color so much better. And you can see how those, you just got some blocks of paint on there.
Yeah.
And that looks really, you know, that looks really nice. Because that's a...
And that's the trick of it.
Yep.
Is the blocks of paint. I need some blocks of paint. So I'm going to come over my little hubcap over here.
The hubcap? They're on the front of the car.
Yeah.
Is that what those call those?
Truck was at some point painted this color.
I thought they called those turn signals and headlights.
I don't know.
Hubcaps, whatever
this little shape is over here that Mr. Car person is having a moment about. Mr. Car person. I'm going to come down here. And I'm going to strengthen this here.
So now you're using a bright paintbrush.
I'm using a bright.
And that's...
It's dry. It's very dry.
Now, a bright paintbrush has short, stiff bristles?
Well, they can have long or short bristles. I have a short handle. Bright with short Teclon bristles.
So that's actually considered a short handle?
This is the short handle.
Wow.
You can see the long handle.
Yeah.
I think I'm just not... I just don't have a long handle brush temperament is what it is.
Hmm. And the bright just means it's got those nice sharp edges.
It's a square with sharp, sharp edges.
Okay.
So I'm going to come along here. I'm leaving my nice dark line. Keeping my beautiful lines. One of the things to keep on these cars is their beautiful lines. They're beautiful lines. Especially the Tri-5 era.
Oh, this is a Ford truck. Tri-5 is typically Chevy.
John, what are you talking about? I've been online.
Well,
I know you're like Mr. Chevy Chevy.
Because 55, 56, and 57 Chevys were the Tri-5 era of...
But this is the beginning of all the line. And it's true. This is 1945. Maybe it's before Ford became evil or whatever. I don't know what you're...
They're not evil. They're just, you know...
You just have a lot of feelings about Fords, man. I didn't know. I guess I should have painted
it's
Chevy.
It's not that I have a lot of feelings about Fords. They're just easy to pick on.
Oh, wow. You're going to get me flamed and trolled, and it's not even my fault.
You know what?
You're going to get me flamed and trolled, and it's not even my fault.
It's not even hard feelings. I mean, like, because the Ford guys feels just the same way, so it's okay.
All right, so I'm coming down here. Now, an interesting thing, there's this dark line here between the two, and we're going to reinforce this. But I'm going to continue it on, this body line, and I'm going to add this little corner, and this will create a delineation of space. Where I put shapes, where I put pattern, again, is the cipher that my brain uses to know certain things. See that? Look at that.
That
orange.
Looks cool.
Isn't that gorgeous? Is it gorgeous?
It really is. I like the orange.
Okay. I'm hoping it's gorgeous because, like, I bet people are like, I don't know. There's, again, hang in with me. Have faith. Don't click away. You can do it.
It's good.
Don't give up on your painting here.
So that's looking pretty cool.
Don't give up.
No, there's. I mean, everyone here is checking this out. They think it's.
Well, I know everybody here today. Who else? I mean, like, you forgot to say who else here today.
We have 82 people in here right now.
I know Mark's here, right?
Yeah, Mona's here.
Hi, Mona.
Mona's been very active on this one. She's really been in here chatting away, and it's been a lot of fun. And actually, there's a couple of really good, really diehard Ford owners in here who've been very tolerant of
me. Oh, really? Of your nonsense?
Yeah, Rose and Stephanie, you know.
Of your total and complete nonsense?
Well, I was saying in the chat, you know, it's I'm not exclusively, you know, heckling Ford owners. There's just, we don't have any Dodges to make fun of today.
Wow, you're just starting it with everybody. You know, I got to live with this channel when you're not here, sweetheart.
I'm pretty much here most of the time, though.
This is just bad.
This is looking really cute, though. So you gonna pull the close-up camera over there on that one a little bit better?
Okay, I could.
Yeah, just swing that around. There we go.
Is it pulling together? I feel like it's starting to pull together.
It's starting to come together.
I love it when a plan comes together. All right. Now, last little... Well, not the last. There's a lot of work on here. I want to tell you guys. Guess what, guys? Must be a busy day. But we're going to give ourselves a rest from the truck for a second.
Yeah.
Yourselves a rest for a second.
This is a big thing.
I'm going to get back into that short bristle filbert that I had, guys. And I'm going to take a little of my burnt sienna, a small amount, over to my phthalo blue. And I'm going to gray out a little phthalo blue. And I'm going to add some white to it. I'm going to get this nice sky color. And I'm going to come here. And over what I had before, I'm going to dry brush. I'm going to scrumble in some better sky color. And the reason I'm scrumbling it in, instead of like, say, painting clouds or doing something that's more skies, I'm trying to keep a unity in the painting of what's happening. Trying to keep a unity in this painting of what's happening. This thing doesn't... This clip, by the way, John, just constantly falls off.
You put it in your pocket.
All it ever does
is fall.
You're
supposed to put that in your pocket. You have that little pocket there? Yeah, it does. Just put it right in your pocket.
Lipstick goes in my pocket. I hear you. Sorry I'm not sipping more today. I hope nobody minds. I'm just gung-ho. I just know how much work we've got to do to get through. This isn't impossible. It's not unachievable for people. There's just a lot to do. Is what it is. And we're still trying to resist the breaking up into a multitude of lessons like you do. So see, I'm just scrumbling this white and blue here. I love scrumbling. And then, I'm getting jawned. Yes, I am. So that creates this beautiful sort of depth of sky. And yeah, it's a totally necessary... It's a completely, completely necessary thing. And while I've got this on here, I'm going to get a little of my burnt sienna and my phthalo blue. I'm going to make quite a dark color. And while we're here, I want to scrumble also in this grill. Later this will matter. We're going to scrumble a little dark color in here. Light brush. I let the purple shine through.
It's looking nice there.
Yeah, we just need to deepen this because this is a very deep space. And the purple, just trust me, it makes a difference shining through. I never ever make you guys do something that doesn't have a purpose. Headlights are going to be fun. Headlights are super easy to do.
You sure those are not hubcaps?
I don't know what we're talking about. These things.
Yeah. I'm giving you a hard time. You called them hubcaps earlier.
Fenders? I don't know what it is.
Yeah, they're headlights on the fenders. You got it.
So, my head has been married a non-gearhead.
She's been so good. She even points out cool trucks now. And this was complete. She went and did the research on this, found this, sent me pictures, and was like...
I did. I figured out the year myself.
Yeah.
I found this picture of a car and I liked the body style, but I didn't like the angle.
Yep.
And so I needed to pull several pictures of different angles so I could extrapolate this in a field. Mm-hmm. And initially in Periscope, if you followed, I thought I was going to get a chicken in here. And then in the middle of painting this, I realized we got no time for chicken. There's no chicken time in this painting. We are going to be just working our little tookuses off. But I want you guys to be able to give this as a gift. So we're going to stay in until it's perfect. Is what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Now I've got this dark blue color that I have here. I'm going to add a little white to it. And then I'm going to, let's see if I gotta show this. I'm going to do some downward stroking here with this, showing the direction of the tires. I know it seems cray cray. That's what we're doing. Some downward stroking. Don't worry too much about the edge. A lot of that disappears into the ether. And then I'm gonna get some dark color going again. I haven't even rinsed out my brush. I'm gonna come right underneath this bumper with this very dark color. And we'll pull it down. This creates the age of the tires. Your tires need to be aged. And tires patina as well, as John will tell you.
Oh yeah.
Which is why we bothered to put so many colors in these tires, because we wanted them to have the wear and tear you'd expect in a tire that had just been parked in a field. See, method to my madness. I'm gonna come over to this side and I'm gonna add this to this tire. It's dark, dark color.
We've had a lot of people suggesting that they could send in pictures of their cars and trucks and things. Uh-huh. And we would love to see those. So please post up on our Facebook page.
Well, I'll tell you what, if a bunch of you do this painting and share it on the Facebook page and the community loves painting cars, then we'll paint some cars. It's exactly what we'll do. If I see a bunch of car paintings come in and you guys are sharing cars and doing cars, then we'll try one of these vintage trucks from the side and we'll try maybe some restored ones. How about the shiny chrome? You know, the one with the fenders and the paint job is good. How do we do that? We know how to do rust. How would we do a really high-end paint job? Which I'm sure you hear a lot from John.
Be cool.
So I've grabbed some Just Brown. I'm just adding a little of this Just Brown to the tire. And so I just want to make sure I have this. And last bit is get some white on your brush that's dirty and add just a touch. See if we can see it. We're going to add just a touch of a reflection here.
Ah.
Just a touch. It's going to be peeking out of the grass, but it matters. Just a touch of a reflection.
Yeah, there's some great suggestions coming in there.
Well, about what?
Oh, they're excited about the idea of being able to do some more stuff.
Well, I mean, I'm just saying it's up to y'all. It's what you send me in. If you guys show like total interest in doing something, then we're going to totally
do it. I'm excited.
I'm
not even going to say the stuff that's coming up there, but you know, like there's motorcycles and semis.
I can show you how to paint all of that. 70s
Mustangs.
I just don't want to start nothing with the train people.
A three-wheeler would be great. I don't know if you guys remember in the 80s, those three-wheeled death machines, like Big Red. I used to love that. If you want to break an arm, get on a three-wheeler. It's like guaranteed.
He's just writing checks I have to cash left and right. I love it.
Oh, that's true. I mean, like...
All right, we're going to do some detail work, John. We're going to add a little shadow up here. I want you to grab a little blue and a little purple.
That's why they made quad runners.
And add a little cad red to it, shockingly. I want you to add not brown, but cad red. So it's going to get a deep color. It's going to be a little different than the burnt sienna. And a little over this, about the halfway mark here, I need you to create a little shadow. Create a little shadow.
What's the shadow for?
And the shadow is going to be a little wider here.
Can you pull that up around there on the closer camera?
Yeah, I need to. Thank you.
There we go.
Okay. So see how it's kind of like a dart shape? I don't know what this actually is. John probably knows what this is, but I've learned painting with my husband in the studio.
Those are actually vents that are on the side
of
the hood.
See? If you don't paint the vent for the car people, then they don't think you painted the car.
Yeah.
So if it has
a
vent, you better put the vent in or they freak out.
Yeah, especially those Fords on that
okay.
vintage
You're
Chevy.
You're so funny.
That your hood, they had those great little nostril vents that made them iconic.
Okay,
in the F1 series.
This is like, it's not even that you have to paint them that well for car people is what I've learned.
No, they just got to kind of be there to,
they just got to be there to say this thing had, and I can see where they're called nostril vents because they kind of look like nostrils. That's sort of interesting. So you're just painting the shadow for what would the nostril vent be. And then you're going to also, while you've got this color.
I don't think that's actually what the Ford guys call them. I just think it kind of, you know.
Probably is. You guys are very literal as a community.
Not very creative.
All right. So
what do you think that what do you call that thing you put on the end
I'm
of a hub?
I'm going to paint a dark map. Purple rectangle here. It's going to be for the license plate later. You're so funny. So this is the purple, blue, and cad red color. All right. This is what we've got. Add a little water to this because I want to extend this out. I want just a little more of it. Just a little more of it, and I'm going to put another little rectangle here.
Now, your materials list says Napthol Crimson.
Please take that out. It shouldn't.
It should say Cad Red Medium.
I don't know how it says Napthol. It shouldn't.
So we'll make sure that we correct that in the description. So anyone who's in there.
It shouldn't. I don't know what happened.
She
had a brain fart, lost my mind,
so if you
fell downstairs. I don't know what happened, but it should say Cad Red.
Now, if you're painting around with Napthol Crimson instead of...
Yeah, it would affect you greatly.
It would affect you greatly?
Yeah.
Oh, so they may be... How bad would that be?
It's a blue-red instead of an orange-red, so you get completely different colors. It's not bad. As long as you have the tonalities and values of a painting will come out, but you would just be very frustrated because you wouldn't be getting the blue I'm getting or you wouldn't be getting the green I'm getting. But we did talk about we've talked about the colors a couple times during the video, so
yeah,
hopefully now, everybody's okay.
Yeah, so you've got both colors that are listed, cadmium red, hue is okay, and naphthol crimson.
Oh, okay, so what that is that's just the full palette.
Ah, okay, I'll go ahead and I'll just pull naphthol crimson right out of there.
Yeah,
then.
It's just the full palette what that is. So as long as you have cad red and you know you need a cad red, then you're not sitting here without the material that you totally needed that you wanted.
Yeah, we just...
And I think... While I'm here, guys, I'm trying to decide, do I feel like this would have...
What's wrong?
I'm just trying to decide. I guess it would have a little red there.
You could have.
Get a little blue and a little red. I just want to make sure this thing is here because, again, I think a little bit of this reflector would be peeking out up here. I don't know if we would would we have the highlight? Would we have the...
You don't need to squeeze it in there. I think it looks pretty good. You know, you're going to have some other stuff popping up.
It there.
It definitely looks like the front end of a Ford.
Okay. Definitely looks like the front end of a Ford. Why do I feel like you're always taking a dig at the Ford every time you say that, though? I don't know. All right.
I think that's just the nature of Fords. They're used to being dug at.
Well, John's teasing Ford people. You can just totally have at him. I'll give you his email after. So I'm going to pull out a little blue. I'm going to add a little of my cad yellow. I'm going to get dark green. You can even add a little burnt sienna to it if you want to deepen it. I've got my short bristled filbert. And I'm going to come down here and I'm going to start putting in the darkest range of what is my plants. I'm doing this sort of little dab stroke. I'm not worried about it too much. I just got to get this first layer of green in. Literally is what this is. I just got to show this first layer of, we have some plants back here and here's some plant-like strokes. Start layering the objects around the tires. This is really just about creating that first layer of depth. I might even take this dark, dark color up here, under here. Get some depth going. And it's about these random little brush strokes that are going to give you that feeling of you've got some plants here, but you can absolutely, in this background, break them out. Feel like you can do it.
Yep.
Feel like you can do it.
I think
it's about this layer right here. And then I'm going to come into this tire again and up over the side here with this green and then fill this all out. This will be important later. It just needs to be dry. It just needs to be dry. Guys, we're getting through this.
We're getting there.
So what do we have left? Don't hang. Don't go away. We've got the patina and this belt detail and the Ford logoing, this crazy grill detailing around the headlights and this reflector, the bumper, and just the window, and then eventually handles. Don't let me forget it.
Yeah,
and the last
82
thing we're
going
to do is the bush that's crawling up over. Our, you can see why I opted out of the chicken now, didn't you?
Yeah, this is big.
I don't want to say no chicken.
But I love it. I love that you're doing those tires are looking really slick down there in the grass.
Yeah, don't they? Once they're done that way, then they look really good. And you're like, oh, that's what that was all about.
Yeah, they look good down there.
Yeah. And it's just, you know, everybody wants to paint a tire black. Don't paint the tire black. Don't do it. Don't do it. The tonalist can do it. Now, tonalists everywhere, I'm like, what are you talking about? I always paint my tires black. So I'm going to get my nice, happy, well-adjusted bright back out.
You're well-adjusted bright. Now, why do you prefer a bright over a... what's the other kind of straight or a...
You mean like a detail round?
Well, no, there's a straight cut. Mm-hmm. Someone was asking about it earlier, and it just scrolled up too fast, so I couldn't get it.
So the reason I prefer the bright over other types of lining brushes is it gives me a versatility of stroke.
And it has
that
shorter...
I personally enjoy. I'm just making sure that this little line here is enforced with this dark blue. I'm going to come up here a little bit. I just want to make sure that I've got this enforced right here. And if you need to, come along here. So I have a little dark blue and brown. And I'm just making sure that that line is enforced. So I've taken a little brown over to my blue. There is not one right brush. And it isn't like, in general, a brush will make or break you. I mean, I can do clouds without a stippling brush. Or without my abandoned cloud brush. I can totally do it. If some brushes will make the workload less for you. So I'm just on the edge of this. You could do this with a detail brush. Whatever brush gives you some control over your paint, you can do this with. I just love the control and crispness of a bright, so that's what I use. Huh. It's my happy space. Like it should be. Now I've got this brown and blue, right, that I've mixed up. And it gives me gray. And if I come and add a lot of white to it and a lot more brown, I will get a very gray color. Right?
Yep.
And that's what I'm looking for, gray without black. And I'm going to make about a quarter of an inch in the center of this. This is the other reason why I like using the bright, that I'm going to leave dark right here. And I'm going to very lightly dry brush this outer edge. Now you could do tape if you wanted to right here. You could tape that to create a very crisp, crisp feeling.
Ooh.
You could. If you want it to be architecturally accurate. And I'm going to make sure that this belting continues down here to the edge. Oops. Right. And then I'm going to dry brush this lighter color.
It's so funny. Mona and...
Dry brush it.
You pull your close-up camera up there a little
Thank
closer.
You.
Yeah.
Dry brush it.
And can you zoom in on that as well?
Yes, I can. If it will help, I can totally zoom in on it, guys.
Mark,
right, we're gonna zoom. Oh,
Mark and Mona have been making jokes. So
what are they joking about?
Mona's now our Swedish fish.
She's our Swedish fish. I love those. It's like the best candy. So I add a little more brown to it, but I'm just trying to make sure that this it's got this nice dry brush right here. So you can see the deep blue. If you need to go back, I've got to go back with a dark color. I've got to. I've got my brown and my blue. Right. So I'm going to, this little line is wider. And then it's going to go narrower here. So I just need to make sure that this center line works out well. I will put a picture. You know what I'll do is I will, I should have said this at the beginning. Well, you know,
What's wrong?
I was like thinking maybe I should have had a picture of this type of Ford, like in a lane or something. But you know, it's a 1945 Ford F-150
farm
truck.
No, F-1.
F-1.
F-1, yeah.
So.
It's not hard to find them.
You can Google search that, so you guys are okay. You know, I always feel like you can Google search whatever I'm working on.
Yeah. And the real reason why we're not just throwing up pictures is we don't own a picture of a Ford F-1 that we can share.
Yeah, they're not our pictures.
They're not our pictures.
This is my picture, but the other pictures are not my picture.
I got lots of pictures of Chevys, but not Fords.
F-150s.
F-1s.
Yeah. But I did find them on Google, and then I worked them together to extrapolate this story. So now I'm going to come along here, and I'm going to make just a little band of dark color right here. This is important stuff, guys. It's about an eighth of an inch. You just want a nice, crisp, salvage edge.
Back out your zooming candle.
Okay, a little bit?
Yeah, just a little bit so we can get all that lovely Ford emblem. There you go.
Because we're going to work the heck out of this Ford emblem, because this is where this is very important for the person you're giving this to. They're going to care in here. They're going to have all these opinions about this.
Yeah. The excursion.
So we're just coming along here. I'm just pulling this down. I'd like to point out that, we are really getting, this is this painting. Like, we are definitely giving you this painting.
It looks really good.
So I'm going to make sure that I've got these nice little lines here. That's really worked out. Now, wipe off your brush, but don't rinse it. And you're going to get into your white, and you're going to get a very light color. And you're going to come here, and you're going to very lightly dry brush. Everything that you learned in the rust is going to apply here. This space, because this paint is also peeling. You want to show that at one time there was a crisp, beautiful factory edge here with this, but currently there is not. That is the cipher that you're trying to create right now, as James George would say. That is the cipher. I like that. But art is a universal language, and that is what we are always doing. We are making ciphers. We are telling stories. And I want to tell a story that once a master painter by hand painted this, but it's aged in a field. It was loved once, but now it's aged in a field. I'm going to come here in the center, and I'm going to make a little short brush stroke coming up here to the center. And John's going to get back on the up-close cam so you guys can see it. So I'm going to pull up the center. And along here, very carefully, I'm going to make kind of a rust line. I don't want it to be perfect, but I want to imply that there's this.
Yeah, this big chunk that she's painting is normally really a solid piece of chromed pot metal. So it really doesn't rust the same way as other pieces. It'll always have that blued, whitish kind of look, which is really cool.
Just a little bit. So I've got that, right? And that really tells a lot of my story. A little trick that you can do is put a little white and a little yellow ochre together, and so that it's just a little bit yellowed, put a little bit of that in here. I wouldn't bug you if it didn't make a difference. It didn't make a difference to the painting. If it didn't make people go, whoa! And we're going to be working some of this down here as well. So the stuff that you're learning up here, you're learning down here. Now, I'm a terrible letterer. All right? But I'm going to try to do it. I'm going to try to do it. And how I did this is I know that the O, right, and the R are right here. And that let me get the D. The good news is this stuff is supposed to have flaked off, so, you know, you could tell part of a story and still be pretty good. Well, I've got this detail brush here. I'm going to just very carefully enforce this line. just a little bit. Force it and form it however you need to feel about it. All right, there you go. There you go. Now I feel pretty good about a lot of that, and the only thing that I might do is take some purple and blue, right, and just tell a little architecture here, a little bit, just a small amount. That's what I did on the little one. I'm going to show you what I did on the little one so you know. And I might even enforce just this darker architecture right here. It's helpful. How you guys feeling? You surviving everything?
I think they're hanging in there.
Are you hanging in? Do we still? What do we have? How many do we have in the room
now? 70 people in here. We have 70, 80 people still cruising in. It's amazing.
Wow. For everyone sharing and making sure other people know about this content, making sure other people know it's out here, thank you, thank you, thank you. That's my husband's. Are you going to put that up, sweetheart?
You can if you want.
I'm going to take a little break. You can show him your truck that you're working on, that he wants me to paint this style of truck.
Oh, at some point we'll do that. I haven't got it all set up. I can
show him your truck.
I don't know where it's at. There it is. That one's mine. That's what I'm working on. My ugly Chevy truck.
Makes him very happy.
It does. It's a hobby.
It's a hobby.
It's a toy.
It's a toy. All right. Bumper.
Bumper.
Time We're back into the bright. Let's get into it.
Let's see what you got.
Let's do it. All right. So I'm going to, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to get the brown, a little bit of the blue. A little white.
Yeah.
I'm going to start coming in here.
Yeah.
Aging up this bumper.
Can you get the zoom up the camera? There you go. There we go.
I
got
to zoom out a little bit though. Wait, wrong
way. There we go.
And there we go. So I'm letting the blue that I put in there earlier underneath show through. And I am, even though this is not a scrumbling brush, I am doing a dry, scrumbly stroke. Like you do.
Yep. Now that scrumbly technique you're talking about, what exactly is scrumbling?
Scrumbling is exactly what it sounds like, which is like with a very light. You're trying to create a dry brush random pattern, and it's just a way of working. There are brushes that are literally designed to do this. And by the way, what I'm doing is terrible for the edge of a bright. It's not good for it.
Not good.
Not good. I do it anyways, and then I buy more brights. Is what I do. And Mom will tell you, too, she can't find a bright that'll hold an edge, even the ones that are guaranteed for life. But it's because both of us do this stuff, we are hard on our brushes. Now, I'm very lightly, just so lightly, going to add a little lightness to this right here down the center. See how I left the outside edge dark? But I added that. Aha! It's very important stuff that I do. It matters to the end of the painting. And you can do this. You can totally do this. Painting is just about the steps. Just about the steps. It's about knowing skills, art skills, how you put them together, and just about the steps. Look at that. So that's aged the bumper up just a touch.
Oh, yeah.
Right, and I'm going to get in there with this again. I'm going to do a similar thing here where I'm going to do a very light. It's so light, but I'm going to leave it still pretty dark, but I'm going to add a little bit of this to that. Just a little. Now, I'm going to add a little yellow to the mix and a little white. I've got a little of this blue, but there's just this tiny amount of yellow in it. It's much lighter color. And here we go. Because at one point, this bumper was probably painted white. Correct, John? Or was it chrome?
Well, it depends. So back in the day, chrome bumpers were kind of rare. They were, you generally get a white painted bumper. But a chrome bumper was pretty fancy. Yeah. So it'd be a pretty big upgrade to have a chrome package.
Be a wealthy farmer is what you're saying?
Well, no. I mean, it's just, generally speaking, at that time, trucks were not at all considered sort of the same type of status as they are today. Nobody had trucks that they would dress up to be, you know, sort of fancy trucks. It wasn't until the 50s when Chevy introduced the fleet side truck and the Cameo that was there really a luxury truck design done. So, yeah, chrome was a big deal for truck guys because they couldn't get it any else.
Has it been quiet in the community? I feel like we haven't taken that many questions or interacted with the community that much.
Oh, gosh. There's been a free-for-all out there of comments and love and questions going back and forth between our community members. There's you know, of course, the steady conversation of zombies and how we should have...
We should full-on have a zombie week.
We should definitely have a zombie week. And then there's been some great sci-fi comments that have been scrolling by.
I'm just adding little highlights of the yellow and white here, more to the yellow, to add some aging to this.
And we have some folks asking if we're done when we're going to do our mail, our viewer mail.
You know what? Nobody's written me lately. I need somebody to write me.
There's actually, Mona says that there's supposed to be something in there waiting for us. So we should have to go keep an eye out for it.
I go a mailbox today.
We'll go look today. But we haven't seen anything here in a little while. I've been out of town
for a
week. I
want to do viewer mail. I love viewer mail.
Yeah.
I love Happy Mail. I love Happy Mail.
We're gonna check out the Happy Mail. Yeah. We'll go check
Seriously.
The box today.
Love it. All right. I know I'm supposed to be getting some Doctor Who cards from James and George over at Ken and George over at Crafts by Two.
Nice.
So I'm just working these lines so that's a little more white and yellow. I'm just making sure that this object is defined but isn't painted in solids so that, you know, it has that feeling of being abandoned and old. Does it have an old abandoned feeling to you, John?
Well, you mean...
All right. Now I get my detail.
All Fords kind of feel that way, but yeah.
Huh?
I said all Fords kind of feel that way, but yeah.
I'm going to get the detail. Now, these usually had some type of... little numbers thing. So just pick some random numbers.
You want to zoom in on that a little better, maybe? As soon as you get that one in. There you go.
Yeah.
There.
These have some random numbers. Just, you can put some, you could put a secret message to somebody you cared about here.
Rose says she's not going to show this to her boyfriend.
She's not?
No, he'll want her to paint it.
Well, paint it for him.
Yeah, I think so. I can't even get my wife to paint me my truck, so I understand.
You're just enlisting people now, aren't you?
Well, I figure if enough of your fans revolt against it, you'll paint a Chevy, too.
I'm going to be in here next year just paint cars. I'm going to get a little white, and even though it's not clear, it's got a little, and a little blue, just a little bit of the white and blue, not mixed together particularly well. I'm going to come up to the top up here. And I'm going to very carefully, leaving about, I don't know, like an eighth of an inch, just a tiny amount, a sliver of the dark color behind it, around all sides, I'm going to paint a little highlight of this blue and white. See that right there?
Yep.
And then come over and get a little more white, do the same thing on the other side. It's like a little bent down triangle. And that's like saying there's some glass here. It's just an easy way of doing that. And then we're going to do something super easy in here. I'm going to first get some of this almost pure phthalo blue. And I'm going to do a little dab right here of just the blue, little white on it, mostly the phthalo. And do something similar over here. Okay, then I want you guys to not rinse your brush, but just pull some white. Here we go. Very light pressure. Leave some of these dark reflections behind. Follow the curve. Follow the line of this headlight. Leaving some of the dark, but letting these highlights catch. If that doesn't start to feel like glass, right away.
That really does. It really sharpens that up a lot. You want to move the other close-up camera,
yeah,
too?
The thing about glass that gets everybody, and we'll do some glasses, the thing about glass that gets everybody is they want to paint what it is, not what it's showing them. So they want to paint that it's see-through.
Right.
Right? Instead of just painting that it, all you paint when you paint glass is the reflection it casts. It is as solid as anything else that you're painting. It's just the way the reflections cipher that this is a mirror, that it's doing this, and it's reflecting at you. I'm going to get, have to do this with a smaller brush on the other one.
Where are you looking there? Trying to find your brushes?
Trying to find the brush I want. You know how I get filtering through here and I'm like, I need a brush that's like this, I need a brush that's like that. And I want a teeny tiny bright. Ah. I just like this. It gives me a lot of control. This is a small
tiny quarter inch bright.
I just like it. You could do this with a detail brush. I've got to work this and this now.
Okay, you have to move the camera.
I will move the camera.
There it goes.
I just want to show all these as I'm getting them.
Okay.
So I'm gonna come and do a similar thing over here on the smaller little, just another little blue there. Get some white. A small little reflection there. Don't let your brain fill it in. It knows what it is. It speaks the cipher. It absolutely speaks the cipher. Okay. Now with the small brush, I'm gonna take a little of my CAD over to my blue and I'm gonna make very dark color. I'm gonna come up and just outline very carefully with about, eighth of an inch, just tiny, tiny, tiny little dark outline on that headlight. Just a little bit. And now I'm going to get a little white and I'm going to add just a scotch, a smidge to my yellow ochre. I'm going to come around the outside of my headlights as neatly as I can, but not a solid line. And I'll even pull some of these lines out. I'm going to create this little highlight over here. And if you need to, pull some of this paint around.
Those layers just keep adding up.
They just add so much.
So how is your sippy going over there?
It's cold.
Is it?
It's cold. It's cold. It's so very full of mold. No. I'm going to come over here and I'm going to do the similar thing. Now, you'll notice I'm preserving the dark line that I'm creating this sort of, I didn't paint out all my dark. I left some of it there. Right? I didn't paint it all out. I left some of it there. Now, if you did paint it all out, you can go back with a dark outline and just outline around your headlights if you need to. I'm going to add a little of that paint up there, and I'm going to come over here and do that. Mm-hmm. I'm really happy with how this is coming out. So we're really down to this headlight, grill, plants, couple of handles, and this painting is done. Guys, we're nearly done. If you're just like holding on for dear life, how long is this painting going to be? Not much longer. Again, this is art. Art is steps, kind of like life. It's just steps. You keep taking the steps. You keep plodding along. Eventually, a whole painting is going to come out of it.
It will come.
It will come. Your life will come. Your whole painting will come. It will happen. I don't know we were as silly as we have been in the past. I don't know if we were silly enough today.
No, I think today, well, we've been kind of grinding on this one.
This is one that it really requires the instruction to complete it.
Yeah. This is
You guys need the information to do the painting.
Although, we may do something lighter weight next time.
Yeah.
Maybe like a chicken. Or a cat.
Something.
Something simpler.
Yeah.
But cars and are complex objects.
Yeah, they really are. And to get this done, you know, sometimes it's nice to have... I'm going to add some a little of this light color down here so it exists elsewhere. I'll put it a couple places. Now those are just popping, aren't they?
Yeah.
So exciting. So guess what I do next? I take some of this yellow ochre. And I'm going to come back over to that little red spot right there. And I'm going to add just a little bit of this right here. Look at that. And I'm going to add just a smidge amount of the blue to my cad red. And I'm going to add just a little of that color in there. Make sure that that has that look of being there. Rinse it out really, 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 really well. And get some white. It's okay if it has a little of the yellow in it. And just very carefully dab a little highlight here. And you can even add a smidge of highlight to the top of this object against the sky. Shocking, isn't it?
Pretty cool. Ooh.
Pretty cool how that goes in.
That's pretty neat.
So, handles, grill, plants.
Plants.
No chicken.
No chicken.
No chicken. There's no chicken. I might, while we're here, do the handles so we can just work the grill.
Mm-hmm.
Handles are pretty simple. Take a little of your purple and your blue. Add a scotch of the cad red to them so you get a nice dark color. If you need to, add a little burnt. Sometimes you gotta hunt for color, but what we want is a dark, dark color. That's what we want. And we're going to just carefully, right above here, come off with a little, this is a backward C. Come over on the other side, same thing. Now it's a C face in the right direction. And this will look correct once the highlight is in. We just have to put a little highlight in, is what it is. Rinse all this out. All right. Then we're going to just add a little bit of this brown highlight handle. That was a little yellow, a scotch of brown, a little white. And my trick here is I don't paint a solid line. I let it dash. I let it be open.
Yep.
You know, I let it question itself. And I'm going to add just a little more white to this and maybe let it get into the blue. I need kind of a gray color here. I'm just seeing this. Things you see while you're painting. Sometimes you see stuff that you forgot about when you're painting that you need to deal with. Right? So I'm going to go here because we're missing something in the nostrils.
Hmm.
Halfway down. Little brush strokes that follow this line and get ever nearer. I don't know what this thing actually
is. You adjust your camera in there? Yeah, they're just a vent.
They're just a vent. Anyways, so we got to paint the highlight of the vent in. It'll matter to somebody later. Makes it look good.
Yep.
Got to just paint the highlight of this vent in. It's just about, it's very light. I don't paint a neat, it's not neat. It's just very light. Woo! Back to my sharp bright.
Just go, go, go.
Go, go, go. Sip, sip, sip.
Sip, sip, sip. Sippy,
sippy. Is anyone painting along? Is anyone trying to get this truck in as I'm
Man, there are a lot of people who are saying, again, they scroll up so fast, but someone was saying they just recently with their cousin maybe painted 7 of your paintings. And they were going to do this one next.
Ooh, that is exciting. That is super exciting. And I really killed myself on this, you guys. I'm really hoping. And you know, here's what I look for out of every painting. If you're wondering what my goal is every painting, my goal is the painting that you guys get. Because again, it's not extraordinary that I can paint a painting. I've been doing it for decades. I would hope by now I'd build up enough skills to paint some paintings. But what is really important to me is when you guys do a lot of a painting, when many of you paint the painting, when you share it with me and it looks great and I know it came together for you. I know I explained it correctly based on your results. When you guys don't get something, I don't actually think it's you. I know it's me. In art, it's the materials, it's the state of mind, or it's the teacher that throws you off, because the skills are all just learnable. I mean, you can learn to ride a bike.
Yep.
I mean, we're not asking people to go out and be like the best BMXer doing triple flips in the universe. This is just, you know, painting and well-being here.
Yeah, and I think Stephanie's painting along with us today.
Hey, Stephanie, art game forever.
Now, I'm curious. There were a lot of people who were asking this as well. You're not having any trouble with your paint drying out, are you?
Even though we're under bright lights?
Yeah.
Yes, of course I do.
You are? What do you do over there to keep that? Just squirt occasionally. I haven't seen you squirt much this time.
I did it at the beginning.
Oh, did you?
It doesn't take a lot. And I'm pretty fast.
Yeah.
And I'm pretty fast. You can always put slow dry blending medium in there. Golden makes a line of very pricey but effective paints called Golden Opens. Whenever they say open in an acrylic, if you see open on the word of a product in an acrylic store, you're like, where are all the stuff? The stuff that says open generally refers to extending the drying time of paint.
Yeah.
So if somebody's saying our brand of paint is very open, what they're saying is it takes a really long time to dry.
Yeah.
And you have to probably actively dry it, like Artist Interactive, with heat or something. Just weird world that we live in.
Yeah. I love the hat. We have so many people out here chatting away. You know, thank you guys for hanging out with us. Please don't forget to comment, like, and subscribe. You know, we really appreciate the comments you guys leave while we're in here, because it helps the other people know what's going on and what you thought of the video, so that they come along.
When you guys, I mean, I love the commenting in here, and I definitely always love doing that with you guys. But what is incredibly important and special in is when you guys make comments after that help the next person be brave enough to paint. In fact, those of you that know this works, like on videos, if you can be like, if you're, you know, you're new, you can do this. Because it's really hard to be new to art and know that you can do it. That's the one area where I'm like, sipping paints. I'm so grateful to them, because so many people are like, oh, I can paint. And I like it. I'm going to make my gray, which is the brown and the blue, a little more brown than blue. And I'm going to add a little white to it. And this color I want to be fairly dark, because I'm going to add a highlight to finish it. So I've got a sharp load on my brush. It's not glopped up, because I don't want it glopped up. And I'm going to make as neat of a line as I can, as straight of a line as I can. You know, it is what it is. Thank goodness for implied line in art.
Now you want to zoom in there a little bit, maybe?
Yeah, I do. So I'm concentrating a little bit, and you may be concentrating a little bit. I'm spacing these out about a quarter of an inch apart. There's probably an exact mathematical thing. The good news is, when I was looking at these in the trucks in the fields, apparently they warp from temperature or something, and they go just a little bit. You can take these just a little bit beyond the grill. But they warp and they break and they fall out.
The tines, yeah.
I don't know why. For a while there, I thought they were made out of wood.
No, it's just the front end of a truck, and that's the first thing that gets hit, so.
The vertical part, the vertical grill, is very rare.
Yeah, I think that, I'm not terribly familiar with Fords, but it may be made out of a pot metal, so that when they do rust through, they just break apart. I've seen other grills like that.
It's some weird material, because it definitely ages out in the field.
I'll have to check that out.
Yeah. I could have done the Chevy Apache thingy, like you were saying, or what was it?
Yeah, you know, like a Tri-5 Chevy, like mine, or an Apache. Or like the one that I saw a picture of. The one I showed a picture of is a late 80s, you know, that's an 80s truck. So it's not as cool as like the round fendered trucks.
For artists, it's actually much harder.
Yeah, the square bodies.
The reason we do these rounded bodies, that we do the rounded bodies at all, is because the square bodies are
really
more problematic. I don't know, too many now. Just work it out.
Yeah, that looks good. You know, it's about the feeling of the grill.
It's about the feeling of the grill. And then what you're going to do, wipe your brush off, but don't rinse it. Pull a slightly lighter color, not a pure white, not a titanium white. It's still going to be an off-white. And where they're dry, add a little highlight. And then that's just because they were at some point white, and then as they sit out in the field and break and rust and bend, the paint flecks off.
Yep, then it rusts away.
It does. Whoops. Well, there. And that happens to me too. Sometimes my hand just goes off track. And what I do is I rinse out my brush, and I come in.
And you erase a line.
And I erase it. Good for you to see how I fix it. Because the paint behind it is dry, I can do that.
Now, do you ever use one of those reusable plastic palettes?
No.
No?
Because I'm lazy.
Are they difficult to clean?
Yes.
What do you clean them with?
Well, you can clean them with, like, Dawn.
Do you get all the paint off of it?
Yeah, you have to scrub all the paint off. It's like a thing.
Oh. Someone was asking.
It's ecologically responsible.
Oh, yeah.
Which is always good, to be ecologically responsible. Woohoo! We're doing it. We're doing it. We're painting a truck. I didn't know if this was teachable, but it's happening. So, yay. I really hope somebody can get this. I really, really hope somebody can get this painting. All that's left is our plants. So pull some, a little white and a little yellow. Probably need to put out some more yellow ochre for me. Gotta use up this tube because I lost the cap.
Oh no.
Yeah.
So we need a 3D printer again so we can print some caps.
That is what the 3D printer for, is to print golden caps. So if this were your first time here and this would be a really rough first time painting, this is definitely like a 2 or 3 hoot difficulty. You would want to remember that when you're doing twigs or when you're doing plants, you're going to want them to be thicker at the base, generally on the branches and twiggly bits, and lighter as they go up. So I'm going to lay in some of these now because I want them layered deep into what I'm putting in.
So get your close-up camera there.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, no problem. There.
Okay. So I'm going to come up here. I'm going to push. I'm going to come up very lightly. Keep this light. Keep it mellow. You don't really need to see this. This is just the structure that you want to have implied in the painting. You want to have it implied in the painting, but you don't want it overwhelming your painting. Right? It's important to not have it overwhelm the painting. You can add a little purple if it's too bright, right? Because contrast will gray things out. Just keep it nice and mellow. And I'm branching out. Got a second little one coming up here. This is just the structure that I'm going to put some of these little leaves and things on. And the other place I definitely know I want one of these coming up is I'm going to want something coming up right here by this tire. So see, I put that there. It's just a light little something, right, that you can see, but it's not overwhelming. Okay. Okay. And I have this little cheap quarter inch filbert.
Little filbert.
Yeah, little cheap quarter inch filbert. It's covered in rice for reasons I don't know. And I'm going to let this do some work for me. I'm going to take a little of my blue and bring it over to my yellow oxide, but I'm going to make a lighter kind of a lighter green. It's not a bright green because the yellow oxide, but it's a lighter green than what I've got going on in the background.
Yeah.
Right? And I'm going to just dab this some places to show that I've got some plants. Right? And some of this I might let be a darker green. Work it back in there. And then sometimes it might get lighter as I'm going. And that's just something that you're going to be working out as you go here. What you're saying is there's these weird little leaves and things happening down here below the truck. Don't work up into your branch yet.
Now, do you have to break in new brushes? Are they like, or are they just kind of like,
no, you don't have to break in new brushes, but you do have to warm a brush up before you paint with it.
Warm it up. Oh, that's what you're doing earlier. You were like sort of pushing it back and forth.
Yeah, just get it ready to do its thing. You do have to warm them up, but...
And is that just from like a little bit of the paint residue causing the bristles to be stiff?
No, that's like my cleaner that I showed earlier has a brush preservative in it. When brushes are shipped out, they have a... It's not a starch, but it's certainly a similar cousin to that.
Yeah.
To hold the shape, and so you have to break that out of the brush.
Ah.
I'm going like this. I'm just breaking up. And I'm going to use highlights at some point to even break that up even more, but I've kind of got that patterning there. Now I'm going to make a very dark green again.
Yep.
Very dark green, which is the phthalo blue. A lot of phthalo blue, a little bit of cad yellow. It's a very dark green. And I'm going to add some dark shrubbery here on this bush. Just a little bit. I'll come back with some other stuff. Now the trick with this, it's like clouds, like with everything in art, is try to avoid making recognizable patterns that people can get stuck in. That's really all it is. I've got some just yellow and some blue, yellow ochre. This makes this sort of deep green. I might add some of these in here. Just looking for tonality. All right, so I've got that.
Looking good.
Looking good.
Looking very good.
Looking very good. Now
that's
I'm
a big
going
painting.
To get.
Oh, wow.
I pull my bright out and I'm going to get some of my yellow and green. I'm going to make a much brighter green. Right?
Some lighter foliage.
And I'm going to add some. Make sure I have enough fluidity to this. This I don't want to be a dry brush. I want to have a nice fluid brush. Right? Want it to be nice and fluid. I'm going to add some grass. Just some grass, which is these sort of blade-like strokes. I'm going to pull just some yellow ochre on, but I didn't rinse my brush. I just wiped it. Adding some of that tonal variance to the foliage. So I'm just breaking this up. A lot of this, and this is why I like the bright, because the bright gives me a different stroke. Right? Now I'm going to get some just of this. This is later in the year, so I'm going to get some of this yellow ochre. And I'm going to start just putting my yellow ochre into this. Isn't that awesome? Creating this highlight of this yellow ochre. Adding that tonality and dimensionality to these old plants, right? Starting to turn, things are not as bright green as they were. I'm going to go back into my bright green, which is my yellow and green. I'm going to add a little white to it. And then just a couple places here. Not everywhere. Just a couple places I'm going to add this brighter foliage. This is very similar to cloud work. Just a couple places, couple blades, maybe a little bit over here. This is where maybe some light is shining through and hitting some foliage and catching those highlights. I'm going to make sure I've got some of these on this little bush up here. Little dabs. This little vine or bush or whatnot that it is. Now one of these trucks is on Paint My Photo, so that's a good front end if you're on there. It's hard, it's impossible to find. And then the rest are on Google. But there's not this truck, because I had to sort of put this truck together because there was, just wasn't this shot. I took little elements from different photos that I liked and put them here. All right, guys. Guess what?
It's looking pretty good.
We did it.
Is it done?
It's done.
Oh, my gosh. You want to hold it up to the palette? Hold it up so we can see it?
Look what you did.
Wow.
Look what you did.
I like it.
Do you like it?
Yeah, and it has that very distinctive Ford-nosed front end, so, you know, those guys would like it.
Do you feel like you guys are ready to paint something rusty and old?
That's pretty good.
You guys ready to delve into that truck and give those gifts to that special gearhead in your life? Be they male or female, because I don't want to be gender. Because I know gearheads come in every gender and place in the world, actually. Because I'm out on the internet and I'm seeing that. There's just a community of gearheads, a strata of people who are like, machinery, I love you.
We do love it.
They do.
We loves it.
To one. How did it go? How do you guys like it?
I guess.
What's anyone saying?
Stunning painting.
Aw.
Excellent. Love it. Beautiful.
Thank you. So I'm glad you guys had
fun.
Thank
you for coming and planting with us. We really appreciate it. This would not be as much fun if we didn't have all you guys out here with us.
Would also be very weird.
Yeah, we really love you guys.
We really do. Thank you very much. I'm glad that you liked this. I'm glad that you had fun with this. And you guys were patient about, you know, John getting back so he could help me in the control booth. And so I'm going to see you guys at the easel really soon. Bye-bye.